Good morning. Welcome everyone to Sharktoberfest. This is our first virtual Sharktoberfest and we're so excited because we've been able to expand. We have people participating, organizations from Florida all the way to Hawaii. Usually, we really focus on the San Francisco Bay Area because that's where the white sharks come every year. They return in the fall. And they're one of the most significant white shark populations in the world. But this year, we're going beyond. And I wanted to introduce you to our hosts. We have from Greater Farallones Association, Sarah Heintzelman. From Shark Stewards, David McGuire. And from Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary, Justin Hull. And myself, Carol Preston, also from Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary. Okay, without further ado, we're going to go to one of our hosts, David McGuire from Shark Stewards.
Hi, everyone. Happy Sharktoberfest. We're really excited to take this annual event international now. So we're trying to do this every year at our Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary headquarters right on the beautiful San Francisco Bay. Celebrating the return of our white sharks after an incredible migration of thousands of miles to feed in our sanctuary. And now we're going to do it online like everyone else so we can keep us all safe, but together we're going to keep the ocean safe, the sharks safe, the whales safe, the whole ecosystem in our National Marine Sanctuary. So we have a really exciting day to celebrate sharks, not just white sharks, but the entire ecosystem and keep it safe, support our marine protected areas, support our National Marine Sanctuaries, and learn and have fun during Sharktoberfest. Thanks for joining us.
And we're so excited to have you joining us today. We have a great lineup of programs. A ton of our partners contributed really great content today. So we wanted to give a special shout out to Aquarium of the Bay, CORE, the Hawaii Institute of Marine Biology, the International Ocean Film Festival, Marine Science Institute, Moat Marine Labs, NOAA Fisheries, Randall Museum, the Marine Mammal Center, White Shark Video, and we have music by the Ukulele Friends Ohana of Marin and Max Delaney. So throughout the day today, we'll have educational programs, crafts, amazing video, fascinating science, and lots of good music. The day will kind of kick off with programs that are more geared towards young children and families. And as it goes on, we'll kind of end with our programs that are geared more towards teens and adults. So thank you so much for joining us today.
One of the many things I love about virtual Sharktoberfest is many of us are in our pajamas and it's going to be a great program today. Again, thanks for joining us. We're going to kick it off with Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary and Greater Farallones Association, followed by Shark Stewards and then Randall Museum. Enjoy virtual Sharktoberfest.
Welcome everyone, my name is Tyler Mears. I'm an educator right here at Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary Visitor Center on Chrissy Field next to the Golden Gate Bridge. We're excited today to bring you virtual Sharktoberfest 2020. We're gonna be telling you a little bit about our amazing sanctuary and the sharks that live there. We're fortunate enough to have four National Marine Sanctuaries in our backyard, including us, Greater Farallones, right off the coast of the Bay Area here. We have everything from the largest whales to the smallest plankton and everything in between. We have a lot of life in our sanctuary. It's what we call a biodiversity hotspot. There's lots of different kinds of living things in our sanctuary. So we're going to check out some of the creatures that migrate to our sanctuary to feed on some of that biodiversity. We get birds from the Arctic, New Zealand, and Chile. We get whales from Central America. We even get the world's largest sea turtle, the leatherback sea turtle, all the way from its breeding grounds in Indonesia. It travels almost 9,000 miles to have a buffet of jellyfish. Another creature that travels pretty far just for a meal is our white sharks. We're celebrating the return of white sharks to the Farallone Islands from their hunting grounds around Hawaii and the White Shark Cafe. So we are going to play a little game to learn more about some of the sharks that live in our Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary. So we're going to play Name That Shark. So I'm going to show you a shark, tell you a little bit about it, and then let's see if you guys can guess which shark that is. So here is our first shark. These sharks are found in all the world's oceans. Known to school in separate male and female groups, they get their name from their deep indigo skin color. So keep that in mind. So, do you think it is a white shark, a blue shark, a soup fin shark, a salmon shark, or a short fin mako shark? You can type your answers in the chat. So you could put white shark if you think it's a white shark, or D for salmon shark. I'll give you guys a couple seconds to get those answers in. See what you guys think. And I think you guys got it. It is indeed the blue shark. These sharks are amazing pelagic sharks, meaning they like to swim out in the open ocean. And since they're swimming out in the open ocean, they're very torpedo-like, very streamlined and aerodynamic. And they have those big, long pectoral fins at their side to help them glide through the water. Let's check out our next shark. These sharks were named after foxes by the ancient Greek philosopher Aristotle. He admired their perceived intelligence and cunning. These slightly warm-blooded sharks belong to the same order as white sharks called lamniforms, and they use their scythe-like tails to stun schooling fish before scooping them up. Awesome. So do you guys think this is an angel shark, a brown smoothhound shark, a seven-gill shark, a thresher shark, or a swell shark? I think you guys got it. It is indeed the thresher shark. Well done, you guys. Thresher sharks are pretty amazing. Big long tails. This is our next shark. They can grow to the length of a school bus. These gentle giants filter feed on dense clumps of copepods, tiny crustaceans about the size of a grain of rice. So those are plankton. They're alive in the water and drifters. So our shark here loves to feast on some plankton. So let's name this shark. Is it a whale shark? An oceanic white tip shark, a megamouth shark, a brown cat shark, or a basking shark? I think you guys got it. It is indeed the basking shark. This is the second biggest shark in the world behind the whale shark. And just like the whale shark, they love to scoop up plankton close to the surface of the water. You can see this shark basking in the sun's rays. Awesome. Let's check out our next shark. These shark relatives are typically found below depths of 100 meters. Preferring to eat invertebrates along the seafloor, they get their name from their long, thin tail. You can see there. Awesome. So is this an Australian ghost shark, a shovel-nosed guitar fish, a spotted rat fish, a ninja lantern shark, or a pointy-nosed blue chimera? You guys got it. It is the spotted ratfish. But if you guys answered ghost shark or blue chimera, you also get some points. These shark relatives are part of what scientists like to call chimera, but they get some different other common names like ratfish or ghost shark. And they're pretty amazing. They're cousins with our kind of classic sharks that we think of, along with rays and skates. So last one for you here. But bonus, there's two sharks in one. Nurseries for these two elasmobranchs, that's our shark family, can be found in bay and wetland areas along the California coast, including Bolinas Lagoon. So let's see what you guys think. Is this a bat ray and a leopard shark, manta and silky shark, bat ray and a poor beagle shark, long nose skate and a spotted eagle ray, or a barn door skate and a leopard shark? Give you guys a couple seconds to get those final answers in. And I couldn't trick you guys. You guys got it. It is the bat ray and the leopard shark. Well done, you guys. So we're really fortunate enough to have all these different amazing sharks in our Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary. We have 16. And in our Name That Shark game, we saw six different shark and shark cousin species, and I didn't use the same answer in the multiple choice twice. So that just gives you a rough idea of how many species of sharks are out there. So I always feel really fortunate and lucky whenever I get a chance to see chondrichthys, our cartilaginous fishes, which is our shark, skates, rays, and chimera. And to learn a little bit more about these guys and what makes them so amazing, I want to turn it over to my friend, Mr. Pete. He's going to show us some amazing shark artifacts. Take it away, Mr. Pete.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary Pier House. My name is Pete Winch. I'm an educator here at the Farallones Marine Sanctuary. And I'm out here at the Pier House with a whole bunch of shark artifacts, mainly jaws, that have been donated to the sanctuary for education purposes over the last 30 years. And what I want to do is talk to you a little bit about shark anatomy. Cool. The first jaw I want to show you is Mako shark jaw. This is the fastest shark on the planet, the shark fin Mako. It can get up to 40 miles an hour. It's a fish eater. It's got slim, pointy teeth on the top and the bottom, adapted to eat slippery fish. If I turn it round, you can see they have this area, let's call it the gums, I'm sure it's got a more scientific word, that consistently generates teeth the whole of the shark's lifetime. So a shark might have 20 to 30,000 teeth in their lifetime. That's because if you're a shark, you haven't really got hands, so if you're swimming through the ocean and you see something you might want to eat, you can't go up and touch it, and feel it, and see if it's good to eat. You use your mouth, your teeth. So you might go up to a piece of wood or a rock, and you might break off a tooth. So it's really important that you have this continuous conveyor belt of teeth regenerating to replace the teeth that get broken off. Short fin Mako. Cool. The next jaw I'd like to show you is actually not a sanctuary shark. It's a tropical shark. It's from the Indo-Pacific area. But I really want to show you this jaw because it shows you the variety of sharks. There's about 500 sharks on the planet, 500 different species. And it's a really spectacular artifact. This is a ray shark jaw. This is a ray shark jaw. You can see it's very different from the Mako shark. It's got teeth that look like hard cauliflower. That's really how I would describe it. They interlock, and these are crushing teeth. This is a crushing, pulverizing jaw because ray sharks eat clams and crabs, and they need teeth like this to crush open the crab and get the juicy meat inside. Imagine if you had teeth like a Mako shark. Your teeth would not last very long if you were eating crabs and clams. So this is a really beautiful jaw. And I guess the back here just generates the teeth constantly and pushes them forward. I'm going to show you a photograph of a ray shark. It's kind of unusual, and it's very, very well named because it's a very, very flat shark. It's like a cross between a ray and a shark. It swims at the bottom of the ocean looking for crabs and clams. Cool. The next jaw I want to show you is from a white shark, a white shark. Most people know white sharks as great white sharks, but if you're a scientist, we like to use the word white shark. And this is a white shark jaw from our collection. White sharks eat fish until they're about 15 or 16 years old, but by that time they get so big, so heavy and long, energetically, it doesn't make sense for the shark to catch one fish, eat it, then have to go and catch another fish and eat it. There's not enough calories. They're expending more energy than they're getting from the fish. So at the age of 15 or 16, they start eating seals and sea lions, and their teeth have evolved as tools to efficiently eat seals and sea lions. If you look at the bottom jaw, look at the bottom row of teeth on the jaw, teeth are slim and pointy, not unlike the mako shark teeth. But if you look at the top teeth, they're triangular, and I'm not sure you could see this, but they have serrated edges. If you feel you can hear that, that's me rubbing my fingernail along the serrated edge. And what I like to kind of think of when I think about shark jaw, the bottom teeth are forks, the top teeth are steak knives. So the shark swims under the seal, ambushes the seal, grabs it with its teeth, the bottom teeth kind of pin the seal, and then the top teeth slice through the seal, giving it a lethal wound so that the shark doesn't have to chase the seal, give it another bite, lets the seal, so it just bites it once, gives it a lethal wound, lets the seal bleed out, and then it can eat it, expending not very much energy. Cool. I do want to show you the back because, again, it's got this like beautiful, beautiful, kind of almost miraculous gum area that's constantly generating teeth, pushing the teeth forward to replace the teeth that are lost. And if you imagine, if you're a seal eater, sooner or later you're going to bite a bone or even the skull of the seal when you're attacking it. You're going to lose a bunch of teeth. So having this adaptation of teeth pushing forward to replace the ones that are broken is really, really important. The last thing I'd like to show you is actually not a jaw. This was an artifact donated by Moss Landing Marine Lab, and it's actually the pectoral fin from a basking shark. And if you look back here, you can see our poster. And Mr. Tyler showed you a basking shark. He showed you the film of this giant plankton-eating shark, 45 feet long. This is the pectoral fin. There are two of them, and you can only see one on this picture. It's kind of like the forward, almost like arms of the shark that they use for steering, tilt them up and backwards so the shark can go up or down or sideways. And this is the artifact, and as you can see, it's huge. It's a massive pectoral fin to help this huge animal steer its way through the ocean. We do have basking sharks in the Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary. We don't have lots of them. Back a couple of years ago, I asked every scientist and every naturalist and every fisherman that I met. Have they seen a basking shark? And I actually got just a couple of answers, like yes, once 20 years ago. So they're not so common here, but they are common, more frequently seen down in the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary. Well, thanks for joining us here at the Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary Pier House. Now back to the main program. Enjoy the rest of Sharktoberfest. Thank you very much. Goodbye.
Hi, I'm David McGuire, the director of Shark Stewards and a partner of the Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary and the association. Happy Sharktoberfest. This is our 11th year with the sanctuary celebrating sharks with our community and all life in our National Marine Sanctuary. So we're here to talk about our friend here, the white sharks, but we really want to celebrate all sharks and the diversity of marine life in our sanctuary, our San Francisco Bay, and world oceans. So I want to share my screen, and I'm going to share not only about white sharks and why we're trying to protect them, but also about other marine life in our National Marine Sanctuary and other species of sharks, including something I'm really excited to share with you, which is a new book that we just published and has just come out about shark science for kids, sharks for kids, that I wrote. So I'm the director of Shark Stewards. It's a nonprofit, and our mission is to protect and restore ocean health by saving sharks from overfishing and the shark fin trade, but also to protect critical marine habitat like our National Marine Sanctuary. And we do that through education and applying education science towards advocacy and conservation policy. We're part of the Earth Island Institute based in Berkeley, which is a larger environmental organization that helps protect the earth, the earth and the ocean. But we talk about the 71%, the salty part. So happy Sharktoberfest. We're here to celebrate sharks in the bay and outside, and the return of our white sharks to our National Marine Sanctuary after a 5,000 mile remarkable migration. I'm a diver. I study sharks with the California Academy of Sciences. I'm a filmmaker and I write for National Geographic. And I'm an ocean voyager. I actually have a very exciting expedition that I'll be sharing with you if you follow us on sharkstewards.org. We'll be going out to the Farallone Islands. Unfortunately, you can't come. Usually we bring the public out and classes that I teach at the University of San Francisco to learn about our sanctuary, to see all the amazing whales and seabirds and other extraordinary life, including the white sharks that return to the Farallones after this amazing migration. But we'll be going out to the Farallones on a research expedition, but also continuing on to other marine reserves in the Northeast Pacific, looking at sharks, but also at human impacts like fishing during COVID. So there's our sanctuary there and our friend the white shark, but also other migratory visitors that come all the way from Hawaii, like the Laysan albatross, to come feed in the rich waters of the upwelling system off of our coastline and the newly recently expanded National Marine Sanctuary, the Greater Farallones, there in green, kind of nesting around that, hugging the Cordell Bank National Marine Sanctuary, an underwater sanctuary, and then abutting to the south to our Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary. And we actually have five National Marine Sanctuaries off the California or the western coast. We have four in California, including the Channel Islands to the south, the three off of our coastline up to Point Arena, and then the Olympic National Marine Sanctuary off of Washington. And these sanctuaries protect wildlife and also habitat like the bottom from oil drilling and bottom dragging that might damage that critical habitat for fish and other animals. We also have this incredible islands offshore, the Farallone Islands, which are very mysterious, but also one of the major areas for feeding for many species of cetaceans like humpbacks and gray whales and blue whales, but also hundreds of thousands of nesting seabirds like these common murres and pinnipeds like the stellar sea lions, the California sea lions, harbor seals, but the favorite shark food, the elephant seals that also are actually on the islands this time of year, are what we call Sharktober, when the sharks arrive and they're preying on their favorite food, the northern elephant seal. And here's a shark off the Farallones feasting on its favorite meal and getting nice and fat and ready to leave the islands again in about 3 or 4 months from now for this incredible migration. We know the sharks do this migration. I think Scott Anderson will talk in the panel discussion today about these satellite and acoustic tags. I don't think you can quite see the satellite tag, but there's an acoustic tag. There's the satellite tag on the back that gives us these movements. And tells us when the sharks are moving all the way out here to what's called the White Shark Cafe. And this is some of the data from TOP, the tagging of pelagic predators at with Stanford and Hopkins Marine Lab. The red shows where the sharks' tags have popped up. White is when they come to the surface. And they're going out here and they're diving. They're feeding, we think, in deeper waters. But we suspect also that they're breeding. And then they come back. There's January through February. Here's Sharktober down here when they're all on our coast. And then they leave in January, February. And they're all offshore right around the middle months of April, May. So we decided to celebrate sharks and turn our attitudes of sharks around and not fear them, but embrace them for what they are, important predators in our marine ecosystems. So I'm really happy to share my book, Sharks for Kids. It's just coming out. It'll be available on Amazon. And it's not just about white sharks. It's about all kinds of sharks. We talk about what is a shark. Sharks are a cartilaginous fish, meaning their bones, or their backbones, I should say, is made out of cartilage, which is like the material between at the end of your ears or between your joints or at the end of your nose. So it's very flexible and it's very light. And sharks are also very ancient. So we talk about the evolution of shark in the book, ancient shark like this Acanthodian, 420 million years ago. Sharks long predate the recent radiation of bony fish like tuna or sea bass, but they don't have as many species. But sharks are extraordinarily conserved. They're highly diverse and radiated and specialized to all ecological places in the ocean. So we talk about the different orders of sharks in the book and all the different types, including the hero of Sharktoberfest, the white shark. We call them white sharks because calling them great is actually superfluous. They are great. But sharks are really weird, really strange, really diverse, including sharks that don't live off of our coastline. And other sharks that do, like the flat sharks, the rays, which are the most speciose in the shark group, the giant manta rays, the reef sharks, and of course our star, the white shark. But off of our coastline, we also have salmon sharks, basking sharks, which are filter feeders, thresher sharks, which come into the San Francisco Bay, broadnose 7-gill and 6-gills that go under the San Francisco Bay and come in to give birth, live birth, and as well as these other species which use the sanctuary and the San Francisco Bay as important habitat to breed, to feed, to give birth, and to do what they do in their ecological roles. We have swell sharks because they gulp water in their swell, horn sharks, spiny dogfish, angel sharks offshore, the stingrays, the guitar fish, these are all in the elasmobranch or the shark group of cartilaginous fish. So highly diverse, highly specialized, many different shapes and forms, but all important to the ocean. So I hope that you can dive in and support your sanctuary, save a shark however you can, go to Shark Stewards, learn about sharks, check out our book, share it with your kid, check out our social media, look at all the other great education material that the sanctuary has online. Be healthy. You can pre-order the book now on Amazon if you look at sharkstewards.org and learn more about sharks and how you can take action to save these sharks, because 25% that we know are threatened with extinction. Many other species, we do not have the data, but what we do know is that sharks get a bad rap. They're not scary. They're really cool. They're really important for the ocean, and we need to learn more, study them, and embrace them. So thanks for watching. Thanks for supporting our National Marine Sanctuary. Get out into your sanctuary, be safe, be healthy, and help us keep our sanctuary safe and healthy and protect it. So I wanna thank you, and I wanna thank all the sanctuary staff that made Sharktoberfest another great celebration for sharks. And of course, my sponsors that support Shark Stewards in the work that we do in education like this, in expeditions like the one we're gonna go on, and in conservation, at like the policies that we introduce. So thanks again. I appreciate you listening. Happy Sharktober and celebrate the sharks. Bye now.
Hi, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Sharktoberfest. My name is Nancy. I work at the Randall Museum, and we love the Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary. They're our best friends. They come to the Randall all the time, and we always come to Sharktoberfest. This year, we're going to be having it virtually. So I'm going to show you a little craft about sharks that I think is super cute. And here he is. He's a shark cootie catcher. He works with your fingers. You can use two hands or one hand. And it's a really simple craft to do at home. If you'd like, you can download a pattern which looks like this. We will give you the link to that, but I got to make my own. So I'm going to start with just a blank piece of paper. Let's see. What color should we make our shark? How about a blue shark? Okay. You can use regular copy paper, or you can use construction paper. Construction paper is a little bit harder to use because it's thicker, but it certainly can be done. This one was made out of construction paper. Okay, so first and foremost, this is a folding project. And if you're folding, you have to start with a perfect square. So our little square, we need a ruler. It's going to be 7 inches by 7 inches. So I'm going to mark that out on my piece of paper here. So I'm going to draw the line one way and draw the line the other way, so that you can see now where my pencil mark is, I hope. That's our square. So we'll take our scissors and cut the square. And we're going to save these pieces because we might need them later. Okay, my piece of paper is actually blue on one side and white on the other side. On the white side, we want to know exactly where the center of this paper is. The easiest way to do that is to put a ruler diagonally one way and then diagonally the other way. Draw a light pencil line, and then you'll know where the center is. So let's do that. I'm going to draw a line this way and another line the opposite way. So then you have on your piece of paper, it's a little hard to see, but you can see where the lines cross right in the middle. That's your center. So you're going to take then each corner and fold it to that center. So just like this, we're going to fold one way and we're going to fold the other way. And fold to the center. So then you have just a smaller square. So now we're going to turn it over so that the folds are on the bottom, and we're going to fold it one more time to the center. This time you probably won't need to find the center because it's easier to see.
But if you wanted to, you could do the same thing. Take your ruler, go that way. Take your ruler, go that way. We're going to fold these into the center. Again, each corner. So you see what I'm doing? I'm folding each corner to the center. I have one more corner. Now you want to make sure these are nice and flattens the edges so it's easy to see what's happening. And then, so you have one side looks like that, and one side looks like four squares, individual squares. Now we're going to fold it in half this way. So we took our flat piece and we folded it in half, like a book. Now we're going to fold it the opposite way. So we folded it this way, now we're going to fold it this way. Okay, now what you see, oops, is four squares that are open like that and four triangles in the middle on the opposite side. So we're going to make sure they're all creased down. And we're going to put our fingers through the squares on the back. We have a thumb and a first and second finger. And now we have our cootie catcher. So my fingers are going through the back, just like that. Okay, so next, with our extra pieces of paper, we're gonna draw the traditional shark fin that comes up out of the water, right? So that's kind of an easy shape to make. You can take your extra piece of paper and fold it so you have two fins, because you're going to have them like this. And we'll make a shape. This on the blue paper, and then we'll cut it out and you have two fins the exact same size because you folded your paper. And then you can shape it if you want, do different things with it. But for right now, we'll go with this. See, it looks like a fin. Now we're going to have his side fins, his body fins. Those can be a little smaller. We'll do the same thing. We'll fold our piece of paper and we'll make a smaller shape like that. Okay, so now we've got two side fins and one dorsal fin. Dorsal means back, so the big fin goes on the back of the animal. So here's our shark. His dorsal fin's gonna go like that. So let's put that on first. We get a little piece of tape. And we do the rolly tape. Everybody knows how to do that. You just roll the tape on itself. And you figure out which side you want to be his back. I want this one right here. We're going to put a piece of tape there. And a piece of tape there. So we put two pieces of tape right there. We're going to put one fin on one side. Oops. I think I got my angle wrong. Yeah. One on that side and the other on the opposite side. So you want to make them line up. And if it doesn't line up perfectly, you can use your scissors to just kind of trim around the part that doesn't work. So now he's got his shark fin. And now he needs some swimming fins off to the side. So that's what our little leftover ones were, the little smaller ones. Same idea. We're going to put a little piece of tape on the fin. Oh, in my case, I guess it would be on the blue side. Because I want the blue to be showing. Like that. All right, so there he is. So, what's an animal without a face? Not an animal at all. So let's make his face. So, since this is the dorsal fin, this is where his eyes will go, up at the top. I'm going to use a black Sharpie. And just whatever shape eye you feel like making, oval, round, whatever you would like, you can do. We'll color it in. It's always kind of cool to leave just a tiny bit of white in the corner. So he looks like he's looking at you, like that. There, he's looking more like a shark now. On the inside, you could use your black. Now you're gonna make the teeth, right? So sharks have very sharp teeth. They happen to have a lot of teeth, so we're not gonna make as many teeth as a real shark would have. But teeth are real easy to make. All you have to do is make triangles. Like that. Those are sharp teeth. So this is a little tricky because you're doing it inside while he's already made. But if you very carefully make a triangle up, down, down, just like that. And then you're going to do all four places where his mouth comes together. So you get something that looks like that. Rah, 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 rah. But what do sharks like to eat? They like to eat other animals, and other animals have blood. So let's put some red in here so that it signifies our shark has just had breakfast. Rah. And there is your shark puppet. It's also known as a cootie catcher.
And again, it's a really easy folding project, and I hope you had fun today. See you soon. Bye, Bob and the Farallones. The Randall loves you.
Well, the shark has pretty teeth there, and he shows them pearly white. Just a jackknife, as old Mackie did,
and he keeps it
out of sight. Shark bites with his teeth in. Scarlet billows start to spread. Fancy gloves, though, has old man eat there. So there's never a trace of red. The sidewalk, Sunday morning, lies a body just losing life. Someone's creeping around the corner. Could that someone be Mac the Knight? There's a tugboat down by the river, don't you know? Where the cement bags just dropping on down. The cement is just never waiting. Five'll get you ten. Old Mackie's back in town. He disappeared day after drawing out all his hard cash. And now Maggie spends just like a sailor. Could it be our boy's done something rash? Now Jenny Diver. Well, the line falls on the right bay. Now that Maggie's back in town,
I said, Jenny Diver,
oh, Suki Tawdry.
Look out, Miss Lottalania, and old Lucy Brown.
We hope that you're enjoying Sharktoberfest so far. And next up, we have a couple great programs. We have a program from the Marine Mammal Center. You get to test your shark and sea otter trivia. And after that, we'll hear from Derek Kraft from the Hawaii Institute of Marine Biology in his program called Dude Who Bit My Board. So tune in and we hope you enjoy.
Hi, everyone. My name is Diane Hardy. I'm the Education Volunteer Coordinator at the Marine Mammal Center. And today we're going to do some Sharktoberfest themed trivia together. But before, I wanted to introduce you to the Marine Mammal Center if you hadn't heard of us before. So the Marine Mammal Center is the world's largest marine mammal hospital and education facility, We're actually tucked away, our main hospital is tucked away in the Marin Headlands, just on the other side of Golden Gate Bridge if you live in San Francisco. And here you can see a view from above of our hospital facility there. So you can see some of the pens and the pools where we keep our marine mammal patients, along with some of the solar panels that you can see on top there that help power the filtration system. And then in the top left, you can even see some of our rescue trucks that we use to respond to the marine mammals that we bring back to our hospital. So we cover about 600 miles of California coastline, going from Mendocino County all the way down to San Luis Obispo. And within that area, we are the first responders to any marine mammals that strand. And the way our patients get to the hospital, the story kind of begins the same. Someone will call our hotline, 415-289-SEAL, and our team of responders will go down to the beach or wherever that animal is located and assess them. And if they decide that it needs our help, that it would not survive without us, we rescue it. So that's what you can see in that top left picture over there. There's some of our experienced team of volunteers. We are a nonprofit, so all our work we wouldn't be able to do without our over 1,200 volunteers doing everything from rescue, which you can see in this picture, to animal care and education. So in this picture, you have some volunteers with boards and a net that are rescuing California sea lion. So once an animal is rescued, we'll bring it back to our hospital facility where we can give the animal an admin exam, perhaps take some samples where we can analyze them in our lab, which is very similar to a lab that you would have at any human hospital. So in that bottom left picture there, you can see Carlos, one of our lab managers, taking a look at one of our blood samples from a patient. And those can tell us what might be wrong with an animal so that we can best treat it. And then in terms of treatment, we also can do a lot of the same procedures and tests that you can at any human hospital. So in this picture on the top right corner there, you can see some of our veterinarians doing an ultrasound on one of our patients there. And then our ultimate goal really is to release every single one of our patients that comes through our door. We want to give them a second chance at life. But what we also want to do is make sure that we're keeping a healthy ocean for marine mammals and humans alike. So we do that through our research of our patients to understand more the diseases that they face and the threats in their environment, and through our education. So in normal times, we would be open to the public and welcoming guests through our doors, telling them all about marine mammals and the different threats that they face. So we're still an essential business, actually. So even though we're close to the public, we are still rescuing and rehabilitating and releasing marine mammals. So this is our current patient count here. We're down to 10. We've released a lot this summer. And if you're interested, you can take a look at our website, marinemammalcenter.org, to see our current patients, what's wrong with them. You can also look at our research papers, and we also have a lot of online resources that we've been creating during this time for all ages, a lot of fun activities to be doing at home. All right, so now that we've talked a little bit about what we do at the Marine Mammal Center, let's play some trivia. So grab a pen and a paper so that you can tally up your answers. We'll be doing 5 questions. They're all true or false questions, and we'll be testing some of your knowledge regarding sharks and marine mammals. All right, if you have your pen and paper, let's move on to question 1. So, true or false, the Marine Mammal Center rescues sharks? And I'll give you about 20 seconds to answer before we reveal the answer. Pictured here is a great white shark, but it's not the only shark found in our California waters. All right, let's see what the answer is. And that is false. So the Marine Mammal Center does not rescue sharks. Marine Mammal Center only rescues marine mammals and the occasional sea turtles. They're not marine mammals, but we will sometimes rescue and rehabilitate them for a short period. But sharks are actually part of the cartilaginous fish family, or chondrichthyes. alongside the rays and the skates that you can see in that right picture. So we do not rescue sharks. So write down if you got that correct or not, and let's move on to question two. So true or false, the Marine Mammal Center rescues sea otters? And again, I'll give you 20 seconds to give you time to answer. On that picture on the left here, that's a picture of our Sausalito Main Hospital. And so we've got some of the pens and pools here with some elephant seals in the foreground swimming around, and then some people on our viewing deck. So looking at our patients. All right, let's look at the answer. And that is true. The Marine Mammal Center does rescue southern sea otters. So we actually began rescuing sea otters in 1995, 20 years after we officially opened in 1975. But since that time, we've responded to more than 350 sea otters. So we're also, on top of rescuing and rehabilitating them, we're also conducting research to expand our knowledge of the many threats that they face. Because sea otters are a threatened species, their population is still pretty small, and they've got a really small range around the Monterey Bay area. And they face threats like demogastric toxicosis, which some of our seal and sea lion patients get at the Marine Mammal Center, along with toxoplasmosis and some shark bites. Now for sea otters with shark bites, a neat little fact is that in the past, we've been able to treat those wounds with honey. We've done the same with some of our seal and sea lion patients. It's actually, honey's got some antibacterial properties. So we've used that on some of our shark bite, shark bitten sea otters. All right, let's move on to question number three. So true or false, sea otters are part of great white sharks' diets? Again, I'll give you 20 seconds. All right, and that is false. Sea otters are not actually a part of a white shark's normal diet. White sharks don't really eat sea otters, at least not on purpose. So when they're younger, when they're juveniles, white sharks have a diet mostly consisting of fish. And then when they become adults, they'll switch to higher calorie food like seals, sea lions, small-toothed whales, that have lots of blubber, lots of energy for them to swim around all day. And but they do bite sea otters sometimes. I mentioned we get sea otters with shark bites, and usually that's because they will mistake them for a seal or a sea lion. So they'll take a bite out of them, but once they do, they'll realize that that is not a seal or sea lion full of delicious blubber. It's just a little fur ball. And they spit it out because it's not very nutritious or tasty to them. But unfortunately, because sea otters don't have that thick blubber layer, those shark bites can be pretty dangerous to them and sometimes deadly. So in that case, we'll respond to those sea otters. All right, let's go on to question number four. So true or false, seals, sea lions, and sea otters are all part of the same marine mammal family. I'll give you again 20 seconds. You can enjoy some pictures of some of our patients actually at the Marine Mammal Center. We've got a California sea lion on the left, Pacific Harbor seal in the middle, and then a southern sea otter on the right. Sea lions are actually our most common patient. All right, let's see how well you did. And that is false. Sea otters are not part of the same family as seals and sea lions. Seals and sea lions are actually part of the pinniped family, which was one of the five groups of marine mammals. So I've got some pictures here of all of them. After the pinnipeds, we've got the cetacean family that includes dolphins and whales, which we'll sometimes also respond to in the wild at the Marine Mammal Center. We've went and disentangled some whales. There's also the sirenians, so that includes the dugongs and the manatees, which don't range in California, so we don't respond to them. And the polar bears, which please let us know in the comments if you're surprised by that answer as to why polar bears are marine mammals, and tell us what you think. But I'll give you the answer right now. Polar bears actually are, they live on water, they live on ice, and they depend on the ocean for their food. Therefore, they're categorized as marine mammals as well. And then sea otters are members of the mustelid family alongside the weasels. All right, and now this is our last question here. So true or false, sea otters are the furriest animals in the world. And I love this picture here. You've got a sea otter mom with her very fluffy little sea otter pup. Very adorable, taking a little nap. Right, write down your answer, and this is true. Sea otters are definitely the furriest animals in the world. They have over 1 million hairs per square inch of their body. So imagine taking a quarter and laying down on a sea otter's fur. Within that that area of the quarter, there's over 1 million hairs. By comparison, our whole head as humans, on average, we've got about 100,000 hairs on our whole head. So sea otters, very, very furry animals, and it actually has a purpose. So as I mentioned earlier, they don't have that thick layer of blubber, so their fur is how they stay warm in these cold California waters. So they've got two layers of fur, an undercoat, and a longer guard hairs, which together act to trap air bubbles within their fur so that when they dive underwater, the water doesn't actually touch their skin. They don't get wet, ideally. So that's why they're constantly grooming, constantly keeping the air bubbles in their fur so that they can stay nice and warm while they're diving for food. All right, everyone, that was all of our questions for today. Please let us know how you did in the comments. Tally up the number of correct answers that you got and tell us, you know, did you get one or two correct? Are you happy as a clam? Did you only miss a couple and you're just utterly amazing? Or are you just simply a Jossim? You got all of those correct. You know everything about sea otters and sharks and the Marine Mammal Center. You are a true shark scientist. And then just, I wanted to say thank you everyone for playing this trivia game with us today. And please let us know in the comments if you've got any questions and we'll do our best to answer all of them.
Hey everybody, I'm Derek Kraft from the Hawaii Institute of Marine Biology. I'm really excited to be part of Sharktoberfest and pretty honored to present. I'm gonna share with you guys some of my dissertation research, which is on transfer DNA from shark bites on surfboards and some other things, titled Dude Who Bit My Board. Some fun Hawaiian shark bite facts. We've had about 120 since 1995. And we like to refer to them as human-shark interactions, not necessarily shark attacks, because that's kind of an aggressive word, and usually the shark's just being curious. Unfortunately, that curiosity, though, can be fatal, and we've had 6 fatalities since 1995. But about 30 of those interactions have just been bites to a surfboard or a sup, one time a kayak. And of those 120, we had 63 were by the friendly tiger shark. About 15 were from reef sharks. 2 of those bites were actually from cookie cutter sharks. We're the only place that actually has cookie cutter shark bites. Usually people swimming the channel between Molokai and Oahu. But about 40 of those are still unknown. We don't know what species were involved, so about a third. And that trend kind of persists throughout the data around the world too. A lot of the times we don't know what sharks were involved in these human shark interactions. So like any other good detective, if you walk into a scene and you're trying to figure out what was going on, what you're hoping for is that DNA was left everywhere. If there's DNA all over the place, hopefully we can collect some of it and find out who was responsible for this. And you might think, well, if a shark bites a surfboard, wouldn't the DNA just wash right off right away? And the fun thing about shark spit is it's actually very sticky. So when you think about how a shark breathes, they take in water through their mouth and it goes out their gills just repetitively all day. So if their spit wasn't fairly sticky, it would actually just wash out all day and they'd have to keep reproducing it. So their spit is in fact very, very sticky. Here's a video of us actually collecting some DNA. This is a tiger shark off Oahu. Right there is where the DNA is transferred to the board.
That was one of the most dramatic things that's ever happened on this boat. Intern, give me a Campari, will you?
On the rocks.
That last part's important because Kaylee is an intern and she's awesome. So once the shark releases the board, we can bring it back onto the boat and actually use some swabs and swab the DNA off the board itself, put that swab in some extraction buffer and take it back to the lab where we do the really sciencey part, which is called DNA barcoding. And for those of you that have never heard of that, essentially what we do is we have the unknown DNA, we extract it, we amplify it, and then we sequence it. And then once we have the sequence back, which is basically just a bunch of letters in a row, we log that into some online databases, and it references all of the DNA that's ever been sequenced and published on before, which is a lot. And we usually get a nice match to the species involved. So in this case, if we were to run this shark, the DNA barcode, and we could find out it is the jaguar shark. So we can use the same thing with this DNA on the surfboards. And lo and behold, when we processed the DNA from that video, it was a tiger shark. We got lots of very positive matches. So we know, hey, this is a tool, it works. We were so excited. We wrote up a paper, we sent it into Journal of Forensic Science, put all of our love into it, sent it to them, and they rejected it. The reasons why was, well, we did it once and it was one species. And so they want to know, you know, can you do this with multiple species and does it work with more than just boards? I gave a talk very similar to this just to some friends at a shark conference, and a good friend of mine, Lauren Meyer, said, you know, we're getting sharks biting things all the time down in Australia. Do you want us to collect some saliva samples for you? And we were thrilled. So her and her team do a lot of shark bite work in the Neptune Islands and New Caledonia and Norfolk Island. So they've actually been collecting samples for us down there over the last year. They've got some bull shark samples, some dusky shark, some tiger shark samples, and some white shark samples. And we just got that data back very recently. I've started to do the DNA extraction and the PCRs have amplified. So I know that we're able to get the shark DNA off of the boards, but I'm just about ready to send it off to sequencing to make sure it's actually all shark DNA. So we're really excited about that. That's coming up around the corner. Additionally, just testing surfboards though, they also do a lot of tests on wetsuits. So this is a picture of a wetsuit that's kind of wrapped around a wood board that they have the sharks bite. And we were able to pull DNA off of the wetsuits as well. So it doesn't necessarily just have to be a board. We aren't hoping to get a real life situation here, but just in case, we have put together some shark bite forensic kits and have them stationed at a few lifeguard towers around the islands. And if there is something like a board or a rash guard or something bit, the lifeguards actually will be able to collect that DNA and we can test this in a real world situation. We're not quite ready to sample on humans yet because the paperwork's very thick and we're just not ready to deal with it. Additionally though, a little extra fun info, we did try this with some fish to see if we could get shark DNA off of fish. We tested this with some hammerheads we have on islands, the picture on the left there. And awesomely enough, this also works. So we're able to get DNA off of bitten sharks or off of bitten fish. This is a really fun tool when you start to think about how often fishermen bring in just a part of a fish, and they can actually lose a lot of their catch to shark bites, especially down in Guam and Saipan. So I did start a project with some of the fishermen down there. I traveled down there and collected some swabs off of the fish. But also what we did was put together a citizen science project where we put together a bunch of these kits and handed them out to the fishermen so that they can collect samples on their own. And we're in the process of them still collecting and wrapping up that. And I hope to get that back and see if we can apply this tool on a broader scale, not just to boards and people, but also to fish and help out fishermen. Thanks to all these lovely people who helped me put together about 30 kits to hand out to the fishermen down there. And that's actually all I have for you right now. I'm hoping to get more results soon. I have a lot of people to thank who are super key in making all these projects happen. And if you guys have any further questions, feel free to email me. You can check out our SharkBite Forensics Facebook page and our Instagram account. Yeah, and hope to hear from some of you. Thanks for listening to my talk.
Ready? Here we go.
Almost heaven, West Macaha, High Ridge Mountain, crystal clear blue waters. All my friends there, hanging on the beach, young and old among them, feel the ocean breeze. Country roads, take me home to the place I belong. Take me home, country road. I hear a voice in the morning call. She calls me as though to remind me of my home far away. Driving down the road, I feel the spirit coming to me from yesterday, yesterday. All my memories, all heaven on high, brown-skinned woman, clear blue island sky, daytime sunshine, oh, 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 so bright, midnight moon a-glowing, stars up in the sky, country road, take me home to the place I belong.
Ted, you got it?
Country roads, take me home to the place I belong. Let's go. Nakala, take me home. Oh, country road.
Country road.
Country road. Take me home to the place I belong. Kala, take me home, oh country road, take me home, oh country road, take me home, oh country road.
Thank you, Ted.
That was fun.
All right.
Well, we hope you're enjoying Sharktoberfest so far. I am. This is a really exciting lineup, and it's different this year because it's virtual, so we can actually go places we can't normally go when we're at our sanctuary headquarters. So our next guests are Ana Blanco with the International Ocean Film Festival San Francisco, which has a great partnership with NOAA and our National Marine Sanctuary. And we're going to show a film made by a friend of ours called Little Teeth about sharks in Bali. And next, with the Aquarium of the Bay in San Francisco, right on the bay, we'll be having a cast from their tunnel where it has local sharks like seven gills, like soup fins, like leopard sharks, and bat rays. A really great program from the aquarium of the bay. And then finally, Skylar Thomas with White Shark Video will talk about the purpose of white sharks. So we hope you enjoy the program and happy Sharktoberfest.
Hi, my name is Anna Blanco, and I'm the Executive Director of the International Ocean Film Festival. It's my pleasure to welcome you to a special screening of the film festival for Sharktoberfest. We're excited you could join us today, and we hope you enjoy the film that we've selected for you. I'm here with my friend and my colleague, David McGuire, founder of Shark Stewards and a member of the screening committee of the International Ocean Film Festival. Thanks for being here, David.
Thank you. Happy Sharktoberfest.
Thanks. Tell us a little bit about your experience with Sharktoberfest and with the film festival.
Well, we've been doing this for 12 years now, 11 with the sanctuary, and it's a celebration of our white sharks returning to our National Marine Sanctuary after an incredible migration of around 5,000 miles round trip. So we wanted to turn around the Jaws concept, a very powerful film with a very negative impact, and turn it around to celebrate sharks. Sharks are important to the health of our ecosystem. They're not out to get us, and we're happy that they're there because they help keep our ocean clean. So it's about celebrating sharks, not just white sharks, but all sharks and diversity in the bay and in the ocean.
And tell us about the impact that film has in protecting our oceans. We've had a shark block in the film festival for as long as I've been with the film festival, over 10 years now. But tell us about how important it is to use film to impact the protection and conservation of sharks.
Well, you know, speaking as a filmmaker, it's a great way to advocate and get your message across, sometimes in a more entertaining way than the hardcore conservation, which I tend to kind of lapse into at times. So education is super important, and the sanctuary is really, really, it's a strong foundation of our Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary and the association's message and NOAA to educate the public about the health of the entire ecosystem. And they've had some good films also in the International Ocean Film Festival. So showing films is a great way to get a message across all cultures, sometimes all languages. You can watch something, it's very emotional, very powerful, and hopefully motivates people to protect our sanctuary and our ocean. So it's great to have the IOFF in the Sharktoberfest celebration. Usually you're there behind the booth and advocating and getting volunteers and donors to support the festival. But now we're doing it online, like we did an online festival this year, which I think was very successful. Mm-hmm. And trying to get past this COVID and keep going and keep working and keep celebrating our sanctuary and our sharks, and working together to protect it through film and through advocacy.
Great, and thank you, David, and that's true. Usually we are with the folks down at Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary. Usually we're there at a booth showing films from the film festival. So we're glad that you were able to join us today virtually. And I'm gonna tell you a little bit about the film that we've selected for you. We're going to show our trailer first, and it gives you highlights of the film festival. And then the film we picked for you today is called Little Teeth, Saving Sharks on Bali, from Germany. The director's name is Hendrik Schmidt, and we'll tell you a little bit about it. The film is about a surfer on the Indonesian island of Bali who is horrified watching sharks being killed for their fins. So he sets up floating pens and convinces local fishermen who catch juvenile sharks in their nets to sell them to him while they are still alive. Once the stressed sharks have recovered, they are released into a nearby marine park. So tourists can book eco tours, feed the sharks, and even swim with them. So we hope you enjoy the film. Thank you for joining us today. Thank you, David. And happy Sharktoberfest.
Happy Sharktoberfest. Keep saving sharks and showing films.
That's right. Thanks, David.
Bye.
Thank you. Sharks belong to the ocean. They are some of the oldest species on this planet. They have survived several mass extinctions. Sharks maintain the balance in the oceans. Many people are afraid of sharks. They should more fear an ocean without them. These days, immense numbers of sharks and rays are being killed as bycatch of the fishing industry. Live sharks are subject to a flourishing aquarium trade. Every year, tens of millions of sharks are targeted directly and killed for their fins. The demand for shark fin soup has brought many shark species close to extinction. I'm on Bali, on my way to meet Paul from Bali Sharks. Paul is a surfer, and he is saving sharks. Paul spoke to local fishermen who were sometimes catching sharks in their nets. The sharks normally end up on the fish market or in tiny aquariums. Paul convinced the fishermen to sell the sharks to him, alive.
Bali Sharks is a conservation program. We work with fishermen to give them an alternative to killing sharks. A lot of them want to make the right decision. But what happens is they'll catch sharks. We try and give them an opportunity. Hey, keep them alive. We'll take care of them. Once the sharks are healthier and ready to be put back into the ocean, we will release them. We've probably worked with maybe 20 to 40 fishermen now. For them to actually have a decision, I think it's really, it is cool. And yeah, I think they do appreciate it. I've had fishermen return with their kids to see the sharks that they saved a week earlier. Sometimes they'll come by in their boats and just throw fish for the sharks. So I've seen pride, and now the same fishermen are starting to call back, or, hey, my friend's got four baby black tips. That was something I had to consider. Am I going to create a bounty for it, a marketplace for it? Not really, because I'm trying to actually cut out the agent market piece of the puzzle. The fishermen, they're bottom of the barrel. They're going to get paid anywhere from $10 to $40 to maybe a meter-sized shark. He's going to make the same amount of money. He doesn't have to gut it, kill it, fin it, any of that. The guy that makes all the money is the agent, so that same shark would be worth $100, $150 for the fins. We try and create a win situation for everybody, community, tourism, and as well as, of course, the ecosystem and the sharks.
When Paul is not busy saving sharks, he runs eco-tours and education projects. School kids identify species on the local fish market and take samples to test mercury levels that are often critically high in shark products. Tourists can also get into the pens on Shark Island and swim with the rescued sharks. As I enter the water, I'm a little bit excited. There are sharks all around me. It is a very close encounter, but the sharks show no aggression at all. Statistics prove that sharks do not hunt humans on purpose. We are not part of their world. If they saw us as prey, it wouldn't be safe to go into the ocean anywhere on this planet. Instead, sharks have to fear us. Sharks are keystone species. If they disappeared, it could throw marine ecosystems out of balance. And now, their survival lies in our hands. It is a big day for some of the sharks. Having recovered from the stress of being caught by the fishermen, they will be released back into the wild today. To prevent them from being caught again, they will be brought to the Gili Islands, a protected marine park. The selected sharks are placed in oxygen-enriched water to make them fit for the transport. The Gilly Getaway speedboat will bring the sharks to Bali's neighboring islands. There, the release team is already awaiting the arrival of the sharks. When the speedboat arrives, every move has to be spot on to make the release as stressless as possible for the sharks. Black-tip reef sharks must swim to breathe, so it is the first to be released. It quickly swims off into the blue. Bottom-dwelling bamboo sharks can actively pump water through their gills to breathe. And now it's my turn. I'm so happy to give a little shark a second chance. Back in its ocean home, it swims down to the seafloor looking for a hiding place. It has morphed its color now and shows its characteristic stripes. Around the gillies, the sharks are likely to live their full life cycle and keep the ecosystem in balance.
Welcome to the Aquarium of the Bay on Pier 39 in San Francisco. We are dedicated to the research, conservation, and educating the public about our Bay Area ecosystems here in San Francisco. We're standing in the Sharks of Alcatraz tunnel here at the Aquarium of the Bay, part of our 700,000 gallon series of exhibits here. And this is where you find most of the animals that you might see in the deeper parts of the San Francisco Bay, including many of our shark species. So this shark here is the most common shark in the San Francisco Bay. This is a leopard shark. And just like a human with a unique fingerprint, every leopard shark has their own unique set of spots. Now, we have several other kinds of sharks here in the tunnel. And one of them might surprise you. This is a bat ray, another common animal in the San Francisco Bay. And bat rays, it might surprise you to learn, are really closely related to sharks. They're basically flat sharks. And I'll talk more about that in a minute when we look at what makes a shark a shark. This is the newest shark in our exhibit. Now here at the Aquarium of the Bay, we are doing research, not only on the animals in our collection, but on the wild populations of sharks out in the San Francisco Bay. So we have a special research permit to collect seven gill sharks. This is the largest kind of shark in the San Francisco Bay. And these sharks are what's called data insufficient. That means we don't even know how many there are in the wild. The IUCN, the organization that counts and documents how many of a population there are in the wild, it's the organization that gives fish the name endangered or least concern or threatened. That organization doesn't even know how many seven gills there are because they haven't been studied enough. So we go out into the bay and we collect these seven gill sharks. We bring them and keep them in our collection for about 2 years while we study them. And then we release them back out into the bay with a tracker so that we can research their migration patterns. And we're trying to answer questions about not only where they go, but what they eat, how they reproduce, and where they can be found across the oceans. For example, we know that they're found here and in South Africa, but nobody's quite sure if those are the same sharks that are traveling back and forth, or if those are two separate colonies of seven gills. So we are tagging them here to research where they go after they leave our collection. So you might be wondering to yourself, with all these large fish here, what makes a shark? How do we know which animals are sharks and which are fish? And the answer to that is, sharks have some pretty amazing adaptations that are different from other kinds of fish. They are technically their own subgroup of fish, but unlike other fish, they don't have heart. Here, or wiggle your nose, you'll feel that soft material called cartilage. Sharks' whole skeletons are made of cartilage, not bone. And that means not only can they move smoothly through the water without using too much energy, but it also gives them a really special jaw. Now, because their jaw is made of cartilage, and this, by the way, is a juvenile great white shark, so it's a teenager shark. Full-grown great whites get as big as 20 feet long. This guy was probably about 12 feet. But sharks have these soft jaws made of cartilage. The only hard part in their bodies are these teeth. So that means that they can constantly lose teeth. Unlike us, where our teeth are anchored into our skeleton, their teeth fall out of their soft jaw every single time they take a bite. Now that might sound like it would cost them a lot of trips to the dentist, but actually that's a really good adaptation. Unlike fish or humans who wear down our teeth, shark teeth are always sharp because they don't have time to get dull before they fall out. And because they're losing teeth so much, they have multiple rows of teeth waiting and ready to pop right up like a conveyor belt. As soon as they lose their front tooth, their next tooth will swing up and take its place. And that's an amazing adaptation. So we know something is a shark if it has multiple rows of teeth. It's a fish if it only has one row. Now, another way we know is the texture of their bodies. Sharks have what's called dermal denticles, and these are really rough parts on their skin instead of the slimy or smooth scales you might feel on a fish. So sharks have what's called skin teeth or dermal denticles, and they all point the same direction. Because they're so sharp, they cut through the water, allowing sharks to swim really fast. They're also really, really close together. This is a blown up image. They're actually microscopic little teeth. You can't see them with just your eyes. They're so small. And because they're small and overlapped, they keep out germs. Fish, on the other hand, mostly have scales. Now, one more really important difference between sharks and other animals is how they hunt. Sharks use an organ in their bodies that we don't even have. It's called an ampullae of Lorenzini. So in their snouts, they have this organ and running along the sides of their body that picks up little electrical signals in the water. So when fish swim past, they send out little electrical signals. And when fish heartbeat, they send out little electrical signals. And sharks use those signals to hunt. They don't have very good vision. They really depend on feeling movement in the water to hunt. Now that makes them really good at hunting live prey, but it also means they're not very good at seeing what's a fish and what's a person. Sometimes you'll hear about shark attacks, and let me tell you why. Because sharks don't have multicolor vision like we do. When they see a shadow on the top of the water, it's very out of focus for them. Now, if you look at these two shadows, for example, one of them is a seal or a sea lion, and one of them is a surfer. But if you were a shark looking up at the surface of the water, it would be pretty hard to tell the difference. So very, very occasionally, there is a moment when a shark mistakes a person for a seal or a sea lion and takes a bite. But sharks do what's called catch and release. They'll take a bite, they'll taste that human, and they'll say, "Ugh, I wanted an 800-pound seal. You don't taste as good as a seal." So they'll let that human go. Now, it might surprise you, even though movies tell us that sharks are vicious hunters, they actually only kill about 5 people in the entire world every year. The whole world, billions of people, and only 5. I'm standing here above the Sharks of Alcatraz exhibit where we were a moment ago. And in this tank, we have over 20 sharks. Those 7-gill sharks that you saw, and those smaller spotted leopard sharks. Now, this is where they live while they're with us. But like I mentioned, we are out in our research vessel tagging wild sharks regularly to make sure we're getting data on their migration patterns. And this is really important because without that count and that data, it's hard for us to establish whether their wild populations are okay or whether they're starting to be threatened and endangered. Now, this kind of research is really important for marine ecosystems because until animals are counted and designated as endangered, we won't find a lot of lawmakers who are willing to pass protections for those animals. In fact, because of the endangered statuses of a lot of animals in our San Francisco ecosystem, we have many protected areas off the California coast. And these areas are called marine protected areas. If you've ever been to a national park out here on the land, they're like that, but under the water. Again, called marine protected areas. The Farallone Islands, Monterey Bay, the Channel Islands in Southern California are all protected. That's really, really important because it gives animals like our sharks a chance to reproduce in safety and make sure that they can make the next generation of sharks so that our ecosystems can stay balanced. Now, you might wonder why predators are important. You might think fish would be better off without them, but actually, they're really important because sharks are balancers on our ecosystems. They eat the sick fish, they keep populations balanced, and they eat a lot of other predators that might threaten fish more than them. For example, let's imagine if all the great white sharks were gone. If we didn't have the Farallone Islands marine protected area, they probably would be. That means that sea lion populations would skyrocket. The sea lions would eat all the fish, and there'd be no more fish for our coastline. So sharks are really important predators. They are keystone species that help keep our oceans balanced. And that's why the research we're doing here really matters. Thank you so much for joining me at the Aquarium of the Bay in San Francisco. You've seen a few of our 24,000 animals and a couple of our 180 unique species here at the aquarium. We hope you'll join us here at Pier 39 once we're open, hopefully towards the end of September. But we also have virtual tours available where we take you behind the scenes to look at how we care for all of our animals, fish, sharks, otters, you name it. Thank you again for watching this and supporting our nonprofit. You can find out more about us at aquariumofthebay.org. Have a wonderful Sharktober.
Hello, I'm Skylar Thomas, and that was a few seconds from my 2015 film titled Elasmo, which I usually show to get the crowd's attention right at the beginning of my interactive live presentation titled Purpose. Today, I'll be giving a very condensed version of that presentation. The concept of this presentation was to use the footage that I've collected over the years of filming my documentaries to answer some of the most common questions that I get from people about sharks. And when people find out that I shoot most of my own footage, one of the questions I often get is, how are you still alive? Do you still have all your limbs? Have you ever been bitten? So I thought, what if I could answer those questions in an entertaining way while providing information about sharks? Now, those of you who have spent time in the water with sharks don't think it's that amazing that I'm unscathed after 20 years and 22 species of sharks. But you've got to remember that there is a huge population still out there that thinks that sharks are like Jaws, or that sharks don't really have anything better to do with themselves than to wait for a human to go in the water so they can bite them. For that matter, a lot of people think that sharks will bite anything and everything in their path. Which brings me to a moment I had while presenting at a school a long time ago, where a young person asked me, pointing at the screen, hey, why isn't that tiger shark eating that fish that's right next to it? And you know how they say kids ask the best questions. Well, this is another example, because as simple as that answer could be, it could actually not be so simple. The reason could be that there was a symbiotic relationship between the shark and that particular species of fish, like a cleaner fish, for example. Or the fish is simply too fast, maybe too poisonous. Maybe the shark just knows not to waste its time and energy on that particular fish. But there's another reason, an overlooked and underplayed but extremely important reason. That fish may just not have been on that shark's preferred menu. Yes, I'm saying that sharks have a preferred menu. Will they eat things not on that preferred menu? Sure, just like you'll eat things that aren't on your preferred menu when you get particularly hungry. With somewhere in the range of 500 species of sharks, rays, and skates out there, of course they don't all eat the same thing. What would be the point of all those different body types and physical adaptations if they were all going around the ocean doing the same thing? On an extreme side of the spectrum, we have the example of the white shark, which is a fish that in its adult life is designed to hunt marine mammals. You can't say that about too many fish. Sure, some sharks might consume the flesh of marine mammals, but only the white shark has the adaptations that have made it an incredibly successful hunter of pinnipeds, which was the inspiration of my 2013 film Balance. We'll look at some other examples later, but right now I want to shift the topic toward food chains and trophic cascades, which actually also help explain why I haven't been bitten. Now, with that many species of sharks out there, this isn't always going to be the case, but usually when you see a graphic of a food chain in the ocean or the food pyramid in the ocean, sharks are usually pretty high toward the top. Apex predators of this sort don't reproduce at a high rate. That is part of nature's beautiful design for maintaining balance. Consider if white sharks reproduced the way that salmon or sardines do. An animal with that sort of physical dominance reproducing on that level would instantly wipe out any balance in the ocean. So we have this beautiful system where animals higher on the food chain that have the physical capability of eating animals underneath of them don't reproduce at a high level. Therefore, they don't wipe out the ones underneath of them and throw off the balance. Conversely, if you remove that animal higher on the food chain, what happens to the population underneath of them? So it is important to maintain this balance. You can't have that balance unless everyone is doing their jobs. In all those illustrations and all those graphics of the food web, there is one animal that you don't ever see listed as an example. Us. We're terrestrial animals. We have absolutely nothing to do with the jobs of any animal in the ocean maintaining our population. Now, as a species as privileged as our own, sometimes we don't think about things like this because we're not engaged in the same sort of life as wild animals. We're not really faced with a struggle to survive. Jobs being fulfilled inside of a food chain just isn't something that we think about on a day-to-day basis, if ever. I know some people like to say that we're in the food chain or the top of the food chain, but the reality is that we're outside of the food chain just kind of taking whatever we want from it without ever facing the consequences of something eating us in return. Maybe there's a bigger population of people out there that have to peek out their doors looking out for cheetahs before they sprint to their car to get to work. I don't know. This state of disconnect comes in other forms as well, such as not really considering the advantages of always having medical care available to us. Whereas in nature, if an animal decides to try to eat another animal or get involved in a physical altercation for any other reason, there are going to be consequences. Even if the animal wins that fight, does not mean it isn't going to leave that fight with wounds that could ultimately hurt its survival in the long run. Now, we, on the other hand, if we're having a really bad day and get in a fight, well, we can go to the hospital and then continue life as usual. Similarly, grocery stores, they don't exist in the wild, but animals have to weigh their need for food with the risks that come with trying to get that food. Again, not something that we really think about. The point being that it does not behoove a shark or any other animal to go out trying to eat things that it doesn't really want to eat or that it isn't familiar with. Could it ever happen? Sure. I mean, there's extreme hunger, there's desperation, there's mistakes, but these are exceptions to the rule, not the rule. And this brings me to the next category of why I haven't been bitten. The fact that I haven't been bitten is no credit to me. It has nothing to do with my physical prowess or abilities as an earthling entering the ocean. Now, for the sake of entertainment, we will have some fun at my expense. There are moments as a diver when you aren't exactly doing your part to ensure survival. Moments when your head isn't on a swivel, or perhaps I was focused on one shark for too long. Awareness was lacking for whatever reason, even if it was only for a moment or two. Yes, I've even turned my back on Jaws. My goal isn't to convince you that I deserve the Darwin Award. It's to change our focus on what I'm doing right or wrong to what the sharks are doing right, and just how rarely they make a mistake. Thank you, sharks. You make far fewer mistakes than I do. And let me also acknowledge that even if I was the perfect diver, aware at all times, with what I have naturally and physically, there is absolutely nothing I could do to stop a shark that wanted me. Over the years, I've been in the water with sharks on numerous occasions where there were pieces of bait floating in the water around me. Whether that be with blue sharks, oceanic white tips, bulls, oceanic black tips, and it just became more and more apparent that they clearly knew what they wanted. Not only were they not biting me, but they weren't biting other random objects, and they weren't injuring each other, which I find astonishing considering the high rate of speed and competitiveness that is taking place in these situations. And in the case of nurse sharks, where I knew the consequences weren't going to be that bad, I went so far as to see if I could trick a shark into biting me. And I couldn't. Let's jump way past nurse sharks, and I want to show you some footage from my friend Walter Bernardus in South Africa. This is him riding a white shark. Yes, you heard that correctly. Riding a white shark through a murky ocean of other white sharks, tiger sharks, bull sharks, and oceanic black tips. What are all those animals doing in that same spot? feeding on a whale carcass. How is this footage being captured? By the people in the water with those feeding sharks. Let's change gears again and look at some of my other footage of other sharks and some more examples of their physical design giving us clues about what they are meant to do in the food chain. How about the mako shark, the fastest shark, a shark that is the color of the open ocean? Where do you think it spends most of its time? Where do you think it does most of its hunting? And if it's capable of such speeds, what do you think it, by nature's design, desires to hunt down? On the extreme other end, how about the woebegone shark? Instead of being like a missile, it is flat. It is camouflaged. It is tasseled, blending in with rocks and sand. So do you think it is spending its life in the open, deep blue ocean? Or do you think perhaps it spends its time on the ocean floor? And if so, where do you think the food that it is adapted to eat also spends its life? And what does that tell you about what it probably eats? The white shark and the seven-gill shark, very different sharks, but they share similar waters. This is true in California and in South Africa. But with the seven-gill shark, there's a high likelihood that you will see it cruising through kelp beds, whereas the white shark, probably not as interested, is going through kelp beds. And what about their fins? What about their physical size? What about their shape? Tells you that one might do better spending time in a kelp bed, where the other one might like to be out in the open water. The jobs of these sharks are inherent. They are instinctive. There's no pondering the meaning of life or what they should be when they grow up. There's no career day where a whale shark says, you know what, I think I'd rather eat seals than plankton. Which brings me to us. The human race, a species that does ponder existence, a species that has the ability to choose a career rather than simply trying to carry out an instinctive desire to fulfill a role within an ecosystem. As the dominant species on the planet, we have the privilege of choosing our careers rather than worrying about simply surviving and not being eaten. Rather than eating what we are designed to eat, we eat whatever we want to eat. The purpose of an animal as specifically adapted as a white shark seems fairly clear. The purpose of ourselves, well, not as clear. We have the ability to define our purpose. But what does that mean? What roles do we fulfill? And I don't mean our role as an employee or as a boss, as a teacher or a student, as a mother, father, or child. I mean as an earthling. But after all those years of filming sharks and studying sharks and thinking about their physical characteristics and what one shark's teeth allows it to eat and another shark's teeth allow it to eat and what their fins allow them to do and what their speed and what their camouflage allow them to do, it's only been in recent history that I turned that microscope on myself. What do my physical attributes allow me to do? What can I do without any changes, without any manipulation, without any enhancements added to myself? Yes, through innovation, through technology, we can do just about anything we want to do. But the ability to go underwater with scuba gear does not make us fish. The ability to fly in a plane does not make us birds. Not any more than a gun used on an elephant makes us a lion. Or a giant hook used on a white shark makes us an orca. The ability to kill and destroy does not make us unique. But our curiosity and our fascination and our desire to learn about other animals does. Perhaps instead of gloating about our dominance and the fact that we can pretty much eat every animal on the planet that we want to, we should focus on what truly makes us special as a species. Perhaps we can use our unique gifts to help our fellow earthlings, rather than consuming them all. It certainly strikes me as a more fulfilling purpose.
Hey, aloha, bau, ia, oela, ko papa, lina, la, hila.
Hello, everyone. We have a really special treat up next. We have our very own Max Delaney, who is from the Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary, who actually runs our White Shark Stewardship Program. But today, he's going to have a special set of three songs about sharks. He's also a musician on the side. So I hope you enjoy this little piece of music and can grab something to eat and drink while you enjoy.
The shark baby has such teeth, dear, and he shows them pearly white. Just a jackknife has old McHeath, baby, and he keeps it out of sight. You know when the shark bites with his teeth, baby, scarlet billows start to spread. Fancy gloves though wears old McHeath, babe, so there's never a trace of red. Now on the sidewalk, ooh, sunny morning, lies a body just oozing life. Eek! And somebody's sneaking round the corner. Could that somebody be back the night? There's a tugboat, ooh, down by the river, where there's a cement bag just drooping down. Oh, that cement is just there for weight, B. Five will get you 10. Old Mackie's back in town. Now, did you hear about Louis Miller? He disappeared, babe, after drawing out all of his hard cash. And now McHeath spends just like a sailor. Could it be our boys done something rash? Now Jenny Diver, ooh yeah, Sookie Tawdry, oh Miss Lottie Lania, and old Lucy Brown. All the line forms on the right, babe. Now that Mackie's back in town. I'd ask my friends to come and see. an octopus's garden with me. I'd like to be under the sea in an octopus's garden in the shade. We would be warm beneath the storm in our little hideaway beneath the waves, resting our heads on the seabed in an octopus's garden in the shade. We would shout and swim around because we know we can't be found. I'd like to be under the sea in an octopus's garden in the shade.
Hello, hello, everybody. Welcome back. We've got a great lineup in this next segment. We have the Marine Science Institute with their leopard shark tagging program, followed by NOAA Fisheries and their oceanic white tip shark research. And after that, stick around, we have our awesome and jawsome white shark panel, a panel of shark experts. It's going to include Scott Anderson, Jasmine Graham, Max Delaney, and Christopher Chin, moderated by Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary hostess extraordinaire, Mary Jane Schramm. Thanks for joining us. Enjoy this next part.
Welcome to the Marine Science Institute. In this presentation, what I call The Leopard Shark, MSI and Friends, A Journey Through Time. I'd like to start off with a little bit of scientific information here. That the scientific name, Trichus semifasciata, for the leopard shark, whereas trichus refers to the 3 points on the teeth, and semifasciata means half banded. As you can see on the leopard shark's coloring pattern here, the bars are half banded. They don't go all the way around the shark's body. So trichus semifasciata, 3-pointed, half banded, describes our leopard shark. Next, as we take on this theme of going through time, the leopard shark has actually been an inhabitant of the California coast for over a million years. We find this out by looking at sedimentation deposits that they found in Southern California and analyzing those rocks that have carbon dated to over a million years in age. This is an image of the leopard shark's teeth from a new jaw. You can see the 3 points on the edges of the teeth here, the middle point being the largest. We'd like to get into talking about where are these leopard sharks actually found? What is their habitat and their range? So this is a little baby leopard shark that we had caught on the Brownlee. And since we have this up, we'll just give you some information here. The litters are in numbers of 4 to 33 pups. They gestate in the mother for a period of 10 to 12 months. And when they're born, they're about 8 or 9 inches long. As you can see, this one here is curled up in the palm of your hands. Leopard shark live along the coast from Oregon to Baja, Mexico, the Gulf of California. So where is that? Let's take a look at our chart here. You can see Oregon, California, and Mexico, Baja, Mexico there. Turns out the leopard sharks prefer shallow water, usually 10 to 20 feet, but down to 300 feet deep. And along the coast, let's take a look at how far out that goes. They're really close to the shoreline there. They don't venture very far out over the continental shelf. And whatever substrate you're going to find, whether it's mudflat, kelp bed, rocky, granite, sand, bottoms, they're all types of bottoms, sediments are down there, and you'll find the leopard sharks in these shallow areas. Here we see in San Francisco Bay a mudflat that's at low tide on the left, where the leopard sharks aren't going to survive, so they swim out with the tide, and then they'll swim back in with the tide a few hours later, as you see on the right, where there's high tide filling up the salt marsh and coming into the marsh flats there. Here's an image of what a kelp forest looks like, maybe from a kayaker's point of view. Kind of looks like a bunch of, to me, a bunch of palm trees, leaves littered on the surface of the water there. These are actually the floats and the blades of kelp. Really, to get in there, we need to take a deeper look. So we're going to dive into the kelp beds. And this is what it looks like if you were to scuba dive out in the kelp beds, looking underneath the water. The upper left photograph here, really murky green. That's kind of what it's like diving here in Monterey on a summer's day when there's lots of plankton blooming and clouding up the water. A clear day in Monterey is these other two photographs. To the right and to the bottom That's an exceptionally clear day for Monterey. Comparison, if you were to go on vacation in Hawaii and swim out there, you would not think that this would be a clear day in Hawaii. But in Monterey, these are excellent conditions, probably in the winter time. All right, again, our moment in time with the leopard shark. We haven't been around here at MSI for the last million years, but we have been here for a little while. MSI was initially designed to be a floating classroom to connect students of the San Francisco Bay with the wildlife here in the water. And we pretty much started out with just this vessel here, the Inland Seas, the research vessel Inland Seas. And then over time, we needed to expand and upgrade, and we had manufactured the Robert G. Brownlee, our newest vessel. And we're primarily an education institute. We take students out on the water to teach them about the San Francisco Bay. We're not really set up as a research institution, but our founder, Bob Rutherford, and his son, Jeff Rutherford, our second president of the Marine Science Institute, they mentioned that we can get some science done along the way. Why not? We're out there, we're collecting samples, let's log it out and take some data. So MSI, again, was founded in the year 1970 with the ship operations, the Inland Seas that you saw previously. We started going out rather infrequently, but as the years went by, our voyages increased. And, oh, that's right. We are celebrating our 50-year anniversary this year, 2020. Well, over time, we got up to 2 trips per day. That means 3 otter trawl net tows per cruise, with some weeks operating up to 6 days a week. So that's 6 net trawls per day times 6 days. We had about 36 net trawls a week. That was with the Inland Seas. It has increased now with the Brownlee. Soon we realized that we were out there in the San Francisco Bay catching more fish and sharks than the California Department of Fish and Game. They had a vessel called the Polaris running out of the same port, Redwood City, that we were running out of. And they would go out 1 weekend a month. That means 12 weekends out of the year. And they would report in the scientific journals on what they found in the wildlife of the bay. Granted, they did go into the North Bay and into the Central Bay. We pretty much stick mostly in the South Bay. For the greater part of our operations. Sometime around the year 1998, we started tagging our sharks and we started keeping a log of that. We actually started a little bit before that, but all the data that I found went back to 1998. So where do we get our critters from? Well, before we get there, you can see the two vessels, our initial vessel, the Inland Seas on the right, and our Robert G. Brownlee on the left. You can see the Brownlee is about twice as big. And indeed, it could carry twice as many students, up to 70 students, where the Inland Seas could only carry about 30 students. So we've increased our programs, increased our scope, increased the amount of students we can take out per cruise per year. It's been a huge number of students we've reached. So where do we go fishing? Well, here's a picture of the South Bay. Get a little perspective. We're gonna highlight a few towns and cities. We got Fremont over there in the east, Redwood City, Stanford University, Mountain View in San Jose, and don't forget Alviso. And there's plenty more cities, but if you know what town you live in, you can figure out about where you are. So where's MSI? Well, MSI is right about there, right on the edge of the water. These are our primary fishing locations that we take our boats to go trawl for fish. Most of the fish trawls are over on the upper east shoal of the bay. Sometimes we get below the Dunbarton Bridge in the Magenta region. Sometimes we go to the west side of the South Bay. There's lots of shells and oyster beds and bryozoans down there, which really kind of mess up the net. So we don't go there too often. And occasionally, if the tide is right, we can get out to the north side of the San Mateo Bridge and trawl out there. If the tide is right, to get us out there and back. Here's a chart, a navigation chart of the South San Francisco Bay. You can see the blue areas are actually shallow water, and the large majority of the shoal here on the east side of the South San Francisco Bay is only 2 and 3 feet of water. It's super shallow. So the Brownlee trawls really close to the edge where this white deep water channel of about 30 to 40 feet is. They pretty much stay within a pretty close area over there on the shoals is where we mostly catch most of our creatures. But occasionally we do spend some time up in the North Bay, reaching some students up in the Richmond, San Francisco, Oakland area. And we have a few different trawl sites up there. We only spend about 8 weeks out of the season trawling in the North Bay. Southampton Shoal is between the Berkeley Pier and Richmond. Chrissy Field is right off of Chrissy Field of San Francisco, and McCovey Cove is right over there by the ballpark. Here's a look at what our tag looks like up close, and it has some printing on it. It's just a piece of plastic with printing, Contact Marine Science Institute, Redwood City, California, tag number 2100, please measure, and here's our phone number. So we rely on people, the public, who capture our fish when they're out fishing on the weekends with mom and dad, whether on shoal or on a little boat, to give us a phone call and measure the shark specimens. The only way we get our data back. So what does the tag data look like? Well, the first slide of tag data, this is just the first page here, dating back as far as May 13th, 1998, tag number 419. Now, of the data set that we've had, we found from May 13th, 1998 to December 6, 2019, about a 21-year period, only 602 entries did I find. Of those 622 entries, 335 were males, 275 females, 10 with no gender data. Here we can see one of our instructors, MSI instructor Ashley here, holding a nice leopard shark, a little over 3 feet long. Of those 622 sharks that we've tagged, only 16 sharks have been re-caught and reported to the Marine Science Institute, 9 of which were females, 6 were males, and 1, again, unknown because it was a tag number that we had forgotten to wrote down the gender when we were initially taking the data. Of the data set, all of those recaptured sharks were reported within the San Francisco Bay. So here's a shot of the North Bay. Again, we do some sampling up there, but again, we release the sharks in MSI, and where did they go? Well, Paradise Pier, Tiburon, if you can find Angel Island, in the town next to Angel Island is Tiburon, so up at the top there, Berkeley Pier, okay, that's near our trawl site, when the Berkeley Flats. Treasure Island is another site where someone has captured a shark and called us and told us they found a shark. And then AT&T Park, which I believe now is called Oracle Park. So these are the North Bay site responses of sharks that have been recaptured by people. Someone did call into MSI and told Mary Lou that they caught it from Bodega Bay. Where is Bodega Bay? Well, if you go along the coast about 67 miles north of San Francisco, you'll find Bodega Bay right on the coast of California. So that means our leopard sharks swam out of the South Bay underneath all the bridges, Golden Gate Bridge being the last one, and swam up the coast and was found on Bodega Bay 7 miles north. Now let's take a look at the South Bay. We'll keep in perspective our North Bay relocations, our recapture sites. We're going to add a few more. We're going to add Coyote Point, and then we're going to add the Dunbarton Bridge down south of the Marine Science Institute. And again, our primary trawl sites were the Brownlee, where the Inland Seas goes, and we will actually recapture some of them on our ship. And for a little bit of perspective, let's put in the Marine Science Institute right there. All right, moving on to some more data. Here's some excerpts from the data. Three of the ones that I thought were the most interesting. These were the three largest sharks in our survey. The tag number 461 is a female, released in April 30th, 1999, recaptured almost 3.5 years later, September 28th, 2003. And it grew about 190 millimeters difference between 940 and 1130, again, up by Pac Bell Park. This one's really interesting that the fish tag was changed to a Department of Fish and Game and released. That's pretty neat. So the Department of Fish and Game captured our shark, re-tagged it for their data set, and now that shark is collecting more data. The next two sharks are both males, and they grew just, if you take the two numbers, the release number, growth rate, or size, and the capture size, and find the difference, they grew a little bit bigger than the female, just over 7.5 inches to 8 inches for both of them. And they did it in less time, 1.5 years to 2.5 years, respectively, 596 and 651. So why are the males growing almost twice as fast as the females? There are many different answers to this question. See if you can come up with some. All right. Again, this is about MSI and its friends. It's time here with the leopard shark these last 50 years. So we have some friends and frenemies that the leopard shark have. First off, we have this nice little video here of a leopard shark and a brown smoothhound, both younglings, newly born that season that they were caught, swimming in our bucket together. Now, at this point, these animals are going to be friends. And you see over here, off to the right, we see a California sea lion. You can tell it's a sea lion by the ear flaps on the side of the head. And this is a male. You can tell that by the big bulbous head that he's got right there. And he's kind of having a leopard shark for lunch. All right, so some other friends that we have are the leopard sharks. These are all some more of our cartilaginous animals that we catch, the thornback ray, the brown smoothhound that we just saw in the bucket, the skate, the shovel-nosed guitarfish, and the Pacific electric ray. Pretty amazing animals that we catch here at the Marine Science Institute. Here is a couple of our staff members here. Karen, our ship's director, holding a large seven-gill shark. And then we have one in the palm of our hands, a baby seven-gill shark off to the right. So, you know, when they're young, they're going to probably be friends with the leopard shark. But when they're larger, they're not going to be friends anymore. This seven-gill shark is definitely large enough to eat our 3 or 4 foot leopard sharks that we catch. Which brings us kind of to a food web of the leopard shark. The leopard shark, from what I've read, primarily eats a lot of eggs. It will also eat many different invertebrates on the bottom. It's going to hunt. It's very well adapted for hunting on the bottom. It will eat some of the different fish that are smaller than it when it gets to be larger in size. And when it gets to be large enough in size, it will actually eat the brown smoothhound, a shark that we saw swimming in the bucket, or maybe even some bat rays. Anything that's going to be larger than leopard shark is going to eat the leopard shark, whether it's a seven-gill shark or any other larger sharks, dolphins and porpoises, other marine mammals like orcas, seals, and sea lions. This is bringing me close to pretty much to the end. My name is Christopher Throm, one of the MSI instructors. I've been here for quite a long time. I'd like to acknowledge my nephew, Alexander Throm, who helped me out with this presentation. I'd like to acknowledge Bob and Carolyn Rutherford for founding MSI, giving us a wonderful place to work and teach. I'd also like to thank Mary Lou and the staff, all the staff at MSI and all the instructors at MSI who helped give me a lot of input for this slide presentation. A lot of the content was given by the book, Probably More Than You Want to Know About Fishes of the Pacific Coast by Milton Love. You can find a copy in Mary Lou's office or at your local bookstore.
Aloha, my name is Chelsea Young and I work for NOAA Fisheries Service in the Pacific Islands Regional Office based in Honolulu, Hawaii, and I am in our Protected Resources Division.
Hi, I'm John Carlson. I also work for NOAA Fisheries Service, but in the Southeast Fisheries Science Center, where I'm a research biologist.
And today we're going to give you a brief overview about a really cool shark called the oceanic white tip and what our agency is doing to help recover the species under the Endangered Species Act.
The oceanic white tip shark is a large pelagic shark, meaning it roams the open ocean. It's also highly recognizable by its long paddle-like fins with mottled white markings on the tips, hence the name oceanic white tip. The oceanic white tip shark can be found in tropical and subtropical seas worldwide, but tends to prefer the warm waters in latitudes surrounding the equator. And like many sharks, the oceanic white tip is long-lived and has relatively low reproductive rates. Historically, it was described as one of the most abundant and common species of shark in tropical seas around the world. Back in the 1950s and 60s, the oceanic whitetip shark was so prevalent that fishermen considered it a pest and tried to deter the sharks from taking their catch and bait by throwing sticks of dynamite in the water. But the truth is, we pose a much more significant threat to them than they pose to us. Because their preferred habitat overlaps with areas of high fishing effort, oceanic whitetip sharks commonly interact with commercial fisheries and are caught incidentally as bycatch in longlines, purse seines, and gill nets, among other types of fishing gear. And these interactions are often fatal for the sharks. Additionally, because oceanic whitetip fins are so valuable in the international shark fin market, they have been retained and killed for their fins as well after being caught. These threats, combined with the species biology, have led to significant population declines globally. As a result, NOAA Fisheries listed the oceanic whitetip shark as a threatened species under the U.S. Endangered Species Act in January of 2018, and subsequently began the process of recovery planning for the species. In the Pacific Islands region specifically, the oceanic whitetip shark has declined by more than 90% and is caught as bycatch in all four major U.S. commercial fisheries operating in the region. Therefore, efforts are currently underway to better understand the movements of these sharks, their habitat use, as well as rates of mortality after being caught and released from fishing gear. And this will help inform management decisions in the region and support recovery in the Western and Central Pacific Ocean.
One of the areas where research is being conducted on the oceanic whitetip shark, and where it is still found in relatively greater numbers, is in the Bahamas. One of the questions we need answered to aid in recovery is, are there certain areas where oceanic whitetip sharks are found more than other areas? Sharks are being tagged with both streamer and satellite tags, which provide information on movements and what temperatures and depths the sharks prefer. Information is still in question on some of their basic biology, such as how often do oceanic whitetip sharks give birth. Working in cooperation with scientists from Florida International University and Cape Eleuther Institute, ultrasound is being used to determine if a shark is pregnant or not. The way we do this is that sharks are captured using short hooks on a buoy line and the shark is brought alongside the vessel. The shark is turned upside down, which initiates a sort of anesthesia we call tonic immobility. The animal is then scanned using an ultrasound machine, very similar to what a woman receives when she is pregnant. We also take a sample of the shark's blood to look at the hormone levels to determine if she's not pregnant, if she is mature or not.
Answering these questions about the basic biology of the species will be incredibly important for informing future management decisions and recovery planning as well. In addition, because the oceanic whitetip is globally distributed, occurring in waters of more than 80 countries and caught in many industrial fisheries throughout its range, international cooperation will be paramount in the conservation and recovery of the oceanic whitetip shark.
Hey, welcome to Sharktoberfest and to our panel discussion. They're awesome and jawsome, so why do we have to protect them? I'm Mary Jane Schramm with NOAA's Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary, here in San Francisco. I'll be your moderator today. So I want to welcome you on behalf of the Greater Farallones Marine Sanctuary, the Farallones Sanctuary Association, as well as Shark Stewards. And we're just delighted to have everyone with us today. Now, we only have about a half an hour to have discussions with our panel of four. So this is going to be a little bit like shark speed dating. We'll see how it goes from here. What I'll do is I'll start right now with our panelist introductions. So Scott Anderson, you're up first. And Scott is with the Tagging of Pacific Pelagics, or TOP program, here in North Central California. And he has studied the white sharks of Greater Farallones and the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuaries each fall for, what is it, 27 years thereabouts, nearly three decades. But he's studied them also offshore at the White Shark Cafe, it's a mystery spot for white sharks. Scott knows these animals very intimately, and his efforts have really helped make this particular white shark population one of the best studied in the world. So welcome, Scott. Glad to have you here.
Thank you. And it's good to be here.
All right. So next we have Jasmine Graham, and she's a researcher and project coordinator for the Marine Science Laboratory Alliance Center of Excellence at Moat Marine Laboratory in Tampa, Florida. She is also co-founder of Minorities in Shark Sciences. Jasmine's DNA work helps determine sharks, especially hammerhead sharks, genetic relationships. She also studies their movement ecology and focuses on identifying areas important to small-tooth sawfish to protect them against site-specific threats, including fisheries interactions. So welcome to the West Coast, Jasmine. Glad to have you with us. We also have Christopher Chin, the founder and director of the Center for Oceanic Awareness, Research and Education, or COAR. His work and his footage have been featured on the Discovery Channel's Shark Week. And he's recognized for his work in international ocean health and policy and legislation. So Christopher is also considered one of North America's foremost experts on shark fin policy, having addressed the United Nations on several occasions. So welcome to the group, Christopher.
Thank you much. Happy to be here.
All right, and then last but not least, we have my colleague, Max Delaney. He's the Resource Protection Specialist with Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary in San Francisco. And Greater Farallones is home to one of the most significant white shark populations on the planet. It's certainly the most significant in the northeastern Pacific Ocean. They're all breeding age adults, and so they're the ones that are going to produce the future generations of white sharks. So they enjoy special protections from the sanctuary, legal protections. And Max oversees our White Shark Stewardship Program and handles permitting for activities such as sharks research and shark tourism that might impact the white sharks. So welcome aboard, Max.
Thank you, MJ. Great to be here.
Well, it's great to have you all. Okay. So we're going to get started. Today's awesome and jawsome premise is that although sharks may seem indestructible, they're vulnerable to threats worldwide. So we'll discuss what we know about them, what's being done to help them currently. And since Greater Farallones has one very special white shark population, we're going to try and fit in a little talk about them too, specifically. So let's begin. I've got some questions, and I'll try to touch on each of your specialties. So I'll suggest maybe who might jump in on them. We know that many shark species are highly migratory international travelers. So U.S. protections alone are not going to be sufficient to protect them. How can we protect them better here and outside U.S. waters? And Christopher, this seems to be kind of your special area. So I'm going to ask you to get us started, please.
Thanks, MJ. The shark
populations here are affected by not just fishing, but it's by our consumption as well. We know that here in California, we have the law that protects sharks in terms of shark fins and shark fin sales and distribution. We have 11 other states in the US that have similar protections, but it's not just about the sharks here and about what's consumed here. They're migratory, as you mentioned. So we need to protect them through a series of marine protected areas, through a series of policies. Just like tuna, they're highly migratory. So there is a convention on the conservation of migratory species of wild animals. And that is, its intention is to protect animals through MPAs and through conservation actions and plans. That was actually started in 1979. And there are 131 international parties that have signed on to it. Unfortunately, there are a number of states or countries that have not, including the United States. And Japan and China and Canada and Indonesia, Venezuela, just to name a few. So it's important that countries be involved in international regulations that will help protect species of animals. Similarly, we have CITES, the Convention on the International Trade in Endangered Species, and that one the U.S. is a party to, and that one is one of the ones that people talk about a lot when they talk about shark conservation, because it effectively doubled the number of sharks that we're looking at now. So there are more than 30 sharks and ray species that are listed as protected. But that's just on paper. So we also need to work on port state measures. The long story short is that we all need to work as a community, a global community, to protect the sharks that are that we love so much and that are threatened. And we also need to put teeth behind it, so to say, and actually pay attention to what's going on.
You couldn't resist that, could you?
I actually just came up with that as I was wrapping up. I'm like, ooh. No, we do use that expression in a lot of policy work. Unless there's enforcement, there's really no sense to any kind of legislation or policy action.
Right, it's a very big ocean to police. So international cooperation is gonna be the key. Great, thank you. Okay, so moving on. Sometimes a shark population or even a shark species goes extinct in one area, but it manages to survive in another area. So how can we identify first all the threats that they might encounter, including during their migrations? And what impact do fisheries interactions have on shark survival, and how can we reduce that threat? And Jasmine, I think this ties in with your work. You've worked with the critically endangered large tooth sawfish, and how important are DNA studies to the management of individual shark populations, especially endangered ones? How needful is it that we separate out similar, what look like similar species, but may in fact be completely different?
Yeah, so one of the big things when we're talking about listing things on IUCN and trying to determine what's endangered, what's not endangered, there are a lot of species that were data deficient, where we don't have enough information to determine whether or not they have lost a large amount of their population. And then we also have things like cryptic species. So for instance, with the hammerheads, we recently discovered that there's a cryptic species, the Carolina hammerhead, Sterna gilbertae, that looks exactly like the scalloped hammerhead. And the only way that you can tell the difference is either by sacrificing it and doing a dissection, which obviously, we don't want to just go around sacrificing everything to figure out what it is. Or you take genetics. So we take a fin clip and we do the genetic analysis on it. So that is critical in determining the amount of Carolina hammerheads there are out there, because we recently figured out that all of these sharks that we've been saying are scalloped hammerheads may not all be scalloped hammerheads. And that's really important, because we've got the listing of the scallop hammerheads, but we might be conflating that with the population of the Carolina hammerheads. So if we don't know the difference between the two, we might be doubling what we think is the population of the scallop hammerhead, or there could be very few that are Carolina hammerheads, and we've just been assuming that they're all scalloped, and maybe the Carolina hammerheads are in big trouble. And they can tell the difference between each other because there's not a lot of hybridization. They don't mate a lot together. So apparently there is enough difference between them that they actively don't mate with each other most of the time. So that's a really big, important thing to know, because if one of them is in trouble and we think that they're both fine, then we have some issues where eventually we get to the point where the population might just collapse underneath us and we didn't even see it. So that's something that's really important. And like with movement ecology, with my small tooth sawfish research, we have what we call a lifeboat population of small tooth sawfish here in Florida and in the Bahamas, where the small tooth sawfish is not doing well. One of the two strongholds that we have of small tooth sawfish is here in Florida. And thankfully we have the protected area of Everglades and 10,000 Islands Wildlife Refuge and things like that. But you know, in the Bahamas, there's not that much protection, and that's another lifeboat population. So just like Christopher was saying, you've got to have them protected everywhere, because we can't expect this small population in Everglades to keep the entire species afloat. So it's definitely really important to consider things like local extinctions and what does that mean, where we've lost the large tooth sawfish entirely in the United States. We're rapidly losing the small tooth sawfish. So those are things that are really important to think about, particularly when we're thinking about managing species that exist in different international waters, because they don't know they're crossing the border. They don't have passports. They're just swimming.
Yeah. All right. Well, it seems like you're really doing some very important work on that. And you can do that pretty much non-invasively or minimally invasively to get the DNA samples you need and without actually injuring the animals. So especially with a very critically threatened population or critically endangered, that's incredible. And being an ex-Floridian myself, thank you for protecting the Florida sharks too. So. All right. Here's a good one. Following the release of the movie Jaws, white sharks became the fish we all love to hate. But now everybody wants to go swimming with them, diving with them. And so I do have a question in three parts. Is there such a thing as loving sharks to death? And this can be kind of a big answer in some respects. Second part is, should we risk disturbing them for just to pursue our recreational activities? And the third question would be, are there benefits to bringing people and sharks together in that way? And do those benefits outweigh the potential risks? So I know two of our panelists, Max and Scott, you two have been very directly involved in this issue for quite a few years. So if you could take the lead on the discussion.
Well, I'd be happy to maybe field the first part of that question and talk a little bit about what the sanctuary does, our role in managing the waters and tourism activities around Southeast Farallone Island. I think you asked some really good questions there, MJ. First and foremost, I think that it has been interesting to see the excitement of the general public in the last 10 years wanting to get out into wild places and interact with sharks much more frequently. I think there is a benefit to people wanting to get out and experience sharks up close and firsthand, but I think that we have to weigh very carefully the balance between ecotourism and tourboat activities versus really protecting these natural feeding areas and aggregation sites where white sharks are spending a lot of their time. So I can speak just quickly about what we do in the sanctuary in the greater Farallones area, right outside the Golden Gate, about 25 miles offshore at Southeast Farallon Island. In recognition that there was a lot of boater activity back in the early 2000s, we basically, NOAA, that is, we assembled a lot of stakeholders and researchers and other folks that are very active in the community out that are working in and around Farallon Islands to essentially come up with some regulations that would help us protect this localized population of white sharks that comes to visit Southeast Farallon Island every fall. This is a prime feeding zone. So essentially, we brought together a whole bunch of stakeholders and we determined that given the small geography of this very tiny island, where there's a lot of concentrated breeding age sharks hanging out at one time, it made sense to allow tourism in a very limited way. So not allowing boats to be out there coming and putting other types of bioattractants in the water, but allowing boats to go out there and try to have a much more natural experience. We also passed a regulation in 2009 about restricting the proximity distance to which a boat could get to a shark, in recognition that when these animals are there, they're feeding and they're getting very important calories input for their offshore migration. So basically, we passed a reg that said boats can't get within 50 meters of sharks within about 2 miles of the island. That's their prime feeding area. And personally, I think that it's been a very positive outcome in the sense that while some boats might come out to the island and not necessarily see a shark in any given day, they're actually getting a much better sense of what these animals need, that they're, this is an important feeding zone, and that, you know, we really try to do our best to eliminate conflicts between having too many boats getting in there and altering that to behavior of the sharks and allowing the sharks to basically just do their thing. So I think at the end of the day, it really is just a balancing act. What's interesting for me to also observe these days is in the era, of course, of COVID, and so much of our experiences and day-to-day interactions and educational opportunities now becoming virtual, there are exciting and really innovative, creative new ways in which folks can kind of do fly-throughs for these really prime wild areas and experience what wildlife is doing without having to get out there and necessarily disrupt their natural behaviors. So I think it's interesting to see how tourism might change in the coming years as a result of that.
Great, okay. And Scott, did you want to?
I guess I could add to that. I totally understand why people would want to see a white shark, especially after seeing, you know, all the movies on TV and stuff like that. It makes perfect sense that people would want to do that. And it actually is a positive thing. People come away with an experience. And as you know, MJ, if you go to the Farallones, it's not an easy trip to get out there. And it takes a whole day really to get out there and back. So if you actually are on a regular whale watching boat, you spend a half hour there and then you get out of there just to almost like a place to rest a little bit before you go back out into the real ocean. But on these boats, people are there all day long. And so they have one of those experiences actually that's quite rare, to just sit there all day long and see the place as it is. So there's a really positive thing to people coming out there, but just like Max said, it's a juggling act between too many and not, you know, too many people basically. And in the early 2000s, it was getting out of hand out there, just from personal experience, seeing it go from almost nobody out there at all to lots of sport fishermen. And then, you know, going over to a shark attack was sort of another thing they could do. And they were on the radios and it just got crowded. It's a small place, as you know, and you really can't afford to have too many people there all at the same time. So the Marine Sanctuary has done a great job actually mitigating the problem there. And it feels like, at least from what we've seen, like things have gotten pretty good. Good communication with everybody. People are still fishing for rockfish out there. It's hard to believe that after, I don't know how many years it's been closed to rockfish fishing, you still see people doing that. So it's something that's never gonna go away. So it's good there's a presence on the island actually to watch over the place. Otherwise, during days when not everybody's there, who knows what goes on. So Point Blue and the Marine Sanctuary have done a great job about negotiating the problem with too many people doing too many things there, so.
Well, thank you for that. No, it's, you have the sort of the best eye on what all goes on out there, having been on the islands so many years yourself, and I've been out there a few times, once for 3 weeks, and it was just the most marvelous experience. But truly is, it's like a living laboratory for an amazing assemblage of wildlife, and of course the white sharks being pretty much, did I say awesome before in describing them? I think I did. Christopher, if you, I mean, because you've been with our marine sanctuary, a lot of our outreach events like Sharktoberfest, so education really is important in conservation. And you do a lot of education right in the community here in San Francisco on the shark finning issue, as well as other issues. How do you feel that so much of the important work has to be done in terms of protection from sort of like the grassroots level, and since you work in policy and legislation and sort of the top-down level too, there's like a happy meeting place in between, and it seems like you're covering kind of both ends of the spectrum, which is great.
Well, education is tremendously important, and there are a few different angles to that. One, we at CORE like to look at policy as a form of education. If you think about any kind of controversial policy, if you think about things like even seatbelts and motorcycle helmets going back, when that is first being discussed, people take a side and they feel very passionate about it, and then it's debated and it's argued and it's eventually passed. But in that discussion, all of these points come up. And then in the implementation of it, then there's also further discussion and education. If we think back to the seatbelt law, for example, there were times when people were rabid about it and they would say, well, my car is going to flip over and I'll be trapped and I'm going to die and I'm not going to use a seatbelt because it's my constitutional right to not wear one. And now we all know people who won't even start the car until you put your seatbelt on.
Right.
The same thing goes with the shark fins and other protective measures that might impact recreational or commercial fisheries. People are very, very, very dedicated to their favorite fishing hole or their favorite practice or their favorite meal. And it takes a while for people to understand that the change is for the better over the long term. And that's something that we work on both at the policy level, but reaching out to the community and to schools and classrooms and individuals when we have events like Sharktober, and we get to see a lot of people face to face and really engage with them and have their eyes light up for the first time when they learn something new that they didn't know before. That's where the joy is. And you know, it doesn't matter how old we are or how long we've been involved in a particular aspect of a thing like sharks or shark protection, we always learn something new every time. And that's one of the beauties and signs of somebody who's really in tune, is that they know that no matter how much they know, there's always more to learn. And yes, that's exciting. And one of the reasons why I love getting together with all of you folks, and I wish we could do this in person this year like we have in years past. But yeah, it's a great thing that we're teaching people and getting them excited about sharks and about conservation and protecting them and the world around us.
All right, thank you for that. So we'll all arrange to meet then for Sharktoberfest 2021 in person, I hope. I think that would be great. I think we're running a little short on time, so I'm going to throw out one question for each of you. And we might have some extra time afterwards, but what does each of you see as the best hope for sharks today? So maybe like a one or two sentence, give it some thought for a minute. Best hope for sharks. Who wants to go first?
I'll go.
I think I run into a lot of young people that are very, very interested not only in sharks but other things, and conservation has gripped a lot of people in a way that I don't think people could imagine when I was a kid growing up, really. Yeah, it was different back then. So there is a timing of what's going on here, and is what Christopher was talking about, like people resisting change. Obviously, the coronavirus and this fires and almost everything that's going on these days is teaching us that we need to be a little more open to change. So that's all. Right. Just I think that there's a lot of positive things going on, and it's not all doom and gloom, although it might feel like it at times.
Right. Max?
Well, I know we have a lot of folks here that know a lot more about other shark species than myself. My work has been mainly focused on white sharks, of course, in the sanctuary here off Northern California. But I would say when it comes to that particular species, what I find most heartening is, like Chris was just alluding to a minute ago, that a lot of education and outreach that a lot of folks have been working on for years seems to be very effectively getting through to the public. And there's a mindset that not just in California, but actually now in Cape Cod, where I grew up, Cape Cod, Massachusetts, there's a burgeoning white shark population there.
Right.
On both coasts, we're seeing that the public's really embracing the majesty and the sort of magic of having these animals swimming around in our backyard. And I think that the interest in celebrating and protecting these animals is outweighing a lot of the fear. And so, you know, Cape Cod, for instance, when I go back home to visit family in the summertime, everyone's sporting shark paraphernalia and shirts and baseball caps. And despite the fact that some of their favorite swimming beaches now have, you know, large fish swimming around every single day in the summer, people are embracing it and they're excited about it. They're looking for that thrill to see a dorsal fin breach the, you know, pop out of the surface offshore and then they get a chance to instantly go on social media and talk about how cool an experience that was. And in our own backyard here, to the sanctuary, it's really heartening to see how many people have continued to stay involved with the tours that go out to Southeast Farallone Island, and really, I think, getting more involved in conservation efforts and helping us shift the narrative that these animals, in fact, are, you know, not just vicious, bloodthirsty, you know, man-eaters, as they were referred to back in the day, but that these are very important, you know, apex predators that are an integral part of the ecosystem. You know, there all the time, and I think people really appreciate that.
Okay. Jasmine?
I think the greatest hope for sharks and really a lot of conservation issues is that we're reaching people now that we haven't reached before. So like with Minorities in Shark Sciences, we're reaching out to communities that historically have not been involved in conservation. They're not going to beaches. They can't afford to do things like shark dives. For them, it's maybe they get to go to aquarium one time. So being able to reach people that, you know, historically wouldn't have had buy-in, and say, look, this matters to you. You're connected to the ecosystem too. And just getting people excited and getting to see people that are excited of, yeah, I'm in the inner city in the middle of the United States. I've never seen the ocean, but I care. And that's a really powerful thing to be able to reach people in communities that historically haven't been involved in ocean conservation, and getting them to get excited about it as well.
Okay, thank you for that. And Christopher, we're going to end on you for that comment. So solve all the problems of the world, all the sharky ones.
Well, that's perfect, because my answer, and it's ironic because I developed this before we even started, but my answer comprises the three answers that were prior to mine, because I do believe that youth is super important. Right. I believe that natural curiosity and education is important, and I believe that the reach is important. And I actually believe that it's the combination of those three things, the natural curiosity of youth combined with social media, is really driving and changing the way people look at these animals that decades ago were considered man-eaters and people were deathly afraid of. And when I would first talk about sharks and shark conservation early in my conservation career, a lot of people, especially older folks, would look at me in awe and wonder like, oh, how can you do that? I could never get in the water with sharks. That must be so scary. And now, especially the younger people, they look at me with open eyes and they're like, wow, that's so cool. How can I do that? How can I be involved? And that is the crux, and that is the change that we so desperately need, not just with sharks and sustainable fisheries, but with all kinds of things going on in the world. We need people who care and are passionate about sustainability and the survival of our planet and everything that's in it.
All right, excellent. Well, this gives us a lot of hope, and that's a good note to finish on today. So this ends our Sharktoberfest panel discussion. And thank you all the audience for joining us. And thank you especially to our panelists for sharing your work and some of your stories with us today. And on behalf of NOAA's Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary and the Greater Farallones Association and Shark Stewards, we wish you a sharky good day.
Well, thank you so much, everybody, for joining us for Sharktoberfest today. We hope you enjoyed all the programs. We just wanted to say a special thank you once again to all of our partners who contributed programs today. This truly would not have been possible without all of you. So thank you to Aquarium of the Bay, CORE, Hawaii Institute of Marine Biology, the International Ocean Film Festival, the Marine Science Institute, Moat Marine Lab, NOAA Fisheries, the Randall Museum, the Marine Mammal Center, White Shark Video, and of course to our musicians, ukulele friends Ohana of Marin and Matt Stellini.
Yes, and thank you also at home for participating today. It's been really awesome having you all learn about sharks and research and conservation. And it gives me so much hope for our future and the health of our oceans, having us all come together to celebrate this amazing animal.
Well, and thanks to the Greater Farallones National Marine Sanctuary and the Greater Farallones Sanctuary Association, which is really important to educate and communicate the beauty and the wonder of our national marine sanctuaries, not only here on the West Coast, but on the East Coast as well, and even in our Pacific Marine National Monuments. We're very fortunate to have this system that stewards our whales and our fish and our kelp and sometimes our corals, but also our sharks. So happy Sharktober. Thanks to our partners, but most of all, thanks to you for becoming aware, for embracing the health of our ocean, and that includes sharks. Many species of sharks are endangered, but there's a lot we can do to protect them, like we have our white sharks, which are now returning in good, healthy numbers, keeping our ecosystem healthy and clean. So you can learn how to support more marine protected areas in California and our sanctuaries at sharkstewards.org, and also eat healthy fish that's local, avoid unsustainable fish, and get out into your sanctuary. Take children out to explore and learn and appreciate the ocean, because the ocean keeps us healthy. And now more than ever, we all need to be healthy. So let's get out in our sanctuary and support it. Thanks for coming and happy Sharktoberfest.
Holy Pilivia, Kahibai Ai. Ua ho oku ua uka, noho mai la inu anu. Aoli pili via, kahi mai ao ale koki. Ua ho oku ua uka, noho mai la inu anu.
Anu anu.
Anu anu ma heva heva ao. Ke kali ana i laila, kai no pa ua paa, ko manao ia nei. Anu anu ma heva heva au. Kekale ana ia laila. Kaino pa ua pa a. O ma nao ia nei.
Ua malu.
Ua malu nei ia kino. Mamuli au ko leo. Kanui aku kamana o. Kahi vai au ka pena. Ua malo nei a kino, mamuli au ko leo. Kanui aku kamana o, kahi vai au ka pena. Eki lohi au ikanani, na pua o mana ala. Kaina mai kapuana, kahi vai au ale koki. Eki lohi au ikanani, na pua o mana ala. Kaina mai kapuana, kahi vai au ale koki.
Lava!
When the sun beats down and melts the tar up on the roof, and your shoes get so hot you wish your tires beat with fireproof. Under the boardwalk, down by the sea, yeah, on a blanket with my baby, that's where I'll be. From the park you hear the happy sound of a carousel. You can almost taste the hot dogs, french fries they sell. Under the boardwalk, down by the sea, yeah. On a blanket with my baby, that's where I'll under the boardwalk,
out of the sun,
under the boardwalk,
we'll be having some fun,
under the boardwalk,
people walking above,
under the boardwalk,
we'll be falling in love,
under the boardwalk, boardwalk. From the park you hear the happy sound of a carousel. You can almost taste the hot dog french fries they sell. Under the boardwalk, down by the sea, yeah. On a blanket with my baby, that's where I'll be. Under the boardwalk,
out of the sun,
under the boardwalk,
we'll be having some fun,
under the boardwalk,
people walking about,
under the boardwalk,
we'll be falling in love,
under the boardwalk, boardwalk, boom! Under the boardwalk, with my baby, that's where I'll be. Under the boardwalk,
out of the sun,
under the boardwalk,
we'll be having some fun.
Under the boardwalk,
people walking above,
under the boardwalk. Mana pua ala o nauna, kuhome I aloha ia. Pua mana, kuhome I la haina. Mana pua ala o nauna, kuhome I aloha ia. Kaniyu ku kila kila he nape nape malie ku home I kaulo kaniyu o kaniyu ku kila kila he nape nape malie. Home nani, home ike a e kai, keiko nane akamahina, ike he kai habana vana. Home nani, home ike a e kai, keiko nane akamahina, ike he kai habana bana. Haina ia mai ka puahana, kuu home I la haina, I piha me ka haoli. Haina ia mai ka puahana, kuu home I la haina, I piha me ka haoli.
Lava!
Saw you in my dreams. We were walking hand in hand on a white sandy beach of Hawaii. We were playing in the sun. We were having so much fun on a white sandy beach of Hawaii. The sound of the ocean soothed my restless soul. The sound of the ocean rocks me all night long. Those hot long summer days lying there in the sun on a white sandy beach of Hawaii. The sound of the ocean soothed my restless soul. The sound of the ocean rocks me all night long.
your face again. We were there in the sun on a white sandy beach.
Here we go.
We came on the sloop, John B., my grandfather and me. Round as a town we did roam, drinking all night, got into a fight.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I feel so break up, I wanna go home. Hoist up the John B. sails, see how the mainsail sets. Call for the captain ashore, let me go home. I wanna go home,
let me go home.
I wanna go home, yeah, yeah. Well, I feel so break up, I wanna go home.
Well, the first mate, he got drunk
and broke in the captain's trunk
again.
Constable had to come and take him away
again and again.
Sheriff Johnstone,
Sheriff Johnstone,
why don't you leave me alone? Yeah, yeah. Well, I feel so break up, I wanna go home.
So
hoist up the John B. sail, see how the mainsail sets. Call for the captain ashore, let me go home. I wanna go home,
let me go home.
I wanna go home, yeah, yeah. Well, I feel so break up, I wanna go home.
Ralph, can you give us one? Ralph.
So hoist up the John B. sails, see how the mainsail sets. Call for the captain ashore, let me go home. I wanna go home,
let me go home.
I wanna go home, yeah, yeah. Well, I feel so break up, I wanna go home.
The poor cook,
he caught the fits.
COVID
threw away all of my grits.
Quarantine.
Then he took and ate up all of my corn.
Not my corn.
Let me go home. Why don't let me go home? Yeah, yeah. This is the worst trip I've ever been on.
Well, there was Cancun.
So hoist up the John B. sails, see how the mainsail sets. Call for the captain ashore, let me go home.
Hey, can you do harp?
Let me go home.
Yeah.
I wanna go home, yeah, yeah. Well, I feel so break up, I wanna go home.
Okay, Ted.
Thank you.
you, Ted.
So hoist up the John B. sails. See how the mainsail sets. Call for the captain ashore. Let me go home.
I wanna go home.
I wanna go home. Yeah, yeah. Well, I feel so wake up. I wanna go home.
Well, I feel so break up.
I wanna go home.
Well, the shark has pretty teeth, dear, and he shows them pretty white. Just a jackknife, as old Mackie did, and he keeps it out of sight. Shark bites with his teeth, dear. Scarlet billows start to spread. Fancy gloves, though, has old Maggie there. So there's never, never a trace of red. The sidewalk, Sunday morning, lies a body just losing life. Someone's creeping around the corner. Could that someone be Mac the Knight? There's a tugboat down by the river, don't you know? Where the cement bags just dropping on down. The cement is just there for waiting. Bottle gets you 10, old Mackie's back in town.
About.
He disappeared day after drawing out all his hard cash. And now Maggie spends just like a sailor. Could it be our boy's up something rash? Now Jenny Diver. Well, the line falls on the right bay. Now that Maggie's back in town,
I said, Jenny Diver,
oh, Suki Tawdry.
Look out, Miss Lottalania,
and old Lucy Brown.
Que a la vi que a la
ikke alla mikrona mai.
Mm-hmm.